Yes. Good evening, if we could get started. Thank you very much. Welcome to the September 11th, 2007 school board meeting. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Because today is September 11th and it's the sixth anniversary of September 11th, 2001, would you join me in a moment of silence, please? Thank you. Before we get started and before we get to our adjustments to the agenda, I'd like to introduce and welcome our two school board representatives, Hudson Eakin and Kirsten Brown. Thank you for joining us. Adjustments to the agenda, Alan?
Yes. The only adjustment that I have this evening is under number six, communication. I would like to add an F to that, and that is to speak briefly about Relocate America and the position that Cape Elizabeth has on that list that was announced last week in the newspaper. So that would be 6F.
Thank you. Approval of school board minutes, the August 21st business meeting. Do I have a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes of the August 21st school board business meeting.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any discussion, errors, omissions? All in favor? Thank you. 7-0. The next meeting, August 27th, 2007, special meeting. Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the August 27th, the minutes of the August 27th school board special business meeting.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any discussion, errors, omissions?
I would like to make one comment that
yes.
I felt that it was a very beneficial meeting, and I do want to encourage the CEEA to meet with the town council, as we discussed, and hope that they are able to follow through with that to present a lot of what they shared with us to the town council.
Okay. Anyone else? All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Comments by student representatives. Our two new student reps, I don't know which one would like to maybe go first, but could you tell us just a little bit about yourselves?
Hello, my name is Hudson Eakin. I moved up here from Alexandria, Louisiana 4 years ago, and I'm a musician in a band called The Project, and I'm a senior, and my interests are music and I'm currently thinking about going to college for business at Babson in Boston.
Great. Thank you, Hudson. Kirsten?
Hi, I'm Kirsten. I'm also a senior. I am involved in volleyball at school currently, and I'm hoping to go to college for journalism in Colorado because I used to live there.
Thank you very much. Okay. Comments from the public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone here to comment on non-agenda items? Seeing none, move along to communication. Report on student trip to Guatemala, Susan Dana.
I would like to take this opportunity to introduce this group. As you recall, about a year ago, we came to you, wanted to do a trip to Guatemala. Susan Dana had volunteered to supervise the trip along with her husband, Benson. And early last year, we did a parent orientation meeting. We actually had about 30 people show up, and we filled the trip to capacity. The very next day, we ended up taking 14 students, two adults. And I just want to say, this was such a great experience from the very beginning. Susan was so well organized. The communication between parents and them and community services and then on to the students was fantastic. We had a number of meetings where parents were kept up to date on exactly what was happening. And I have to commend the students on their fundraising efforts, half of which they earned will be donated to Safe Passage. And I think they earned a total of about $3,400. So at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Susan, and she will in turn turn some of this over to the students. So thank you. It was just a fabulous opportunity, and hopefully we'll do it again. Maybe not every year, but we're talking about maybe every other year. So thanks, Susan.
Hi, I'm Susan Dana. I would just like to introduce, there are 14 students that went. They're all Cape Elizabeth High School students. Ben Berman, who is a freshman this year at Cape High School, went, and also did Liz Briggs. She's a sophomore right now at Cape High School. So I'm going to talk a little bit, just kind of give some logistics background, and then they're going to talk about things from a student perspective. I'd really rather have you hear more from the students than from me, because this is really about the students. So this is really just going to be a quick snapshot of what we did. We have a total of 700 photos, and this is down to just 30 photos. We're going to try to keep it. We're really trying to keep it in the time constraints. But actually, if you want to maybe turn it around. Our trip was far more meaningful than any of us envisioned, and it impacted us in many different ways. As I said, the photos you're going to see are really just a highlight. I do want to mention the team members, and we really are. Like one big family now, because we worked a lot from January through June. That's one reason why I think this trip was so successful, because these students worked really hard. We worked together as a group, and the trip was just phenomenal. But the students, the team members, and some just couldn't be here. These students are all very busy, as we all are. But Caitlin Beeling, Ben Berman, Lydia Berman, Liz Briggs, Alana Cooper, Rosie Hewitt, Emily Holliday, Emily McDuffie, Caitlin Pomeroy, Jack Queenie, Paige St. Germain, Becca Strout, Tati Takash, and Rosie Wenberg. We're really very appreciative of the public support for our trip. I did write a letter to the Courier when we returned, so I'm not going to take time now to mention everyone, but everyone in this community has just been so supportive of our trip. And one thing we'd like to do in gratitude, I'm just going to mention this now because this will be quick, but we are going to have a free community presentation on September 27th. From 7 to 8 in the Community Services Building. And that's a time when we really will delve more into what we did on a day-to-day basis. And we have a lot more photos and and people will be able to ask questions at that point too. So I really would like to invite the general public to come to that. There are notices in the Courier, and I've tried to get out quite a bit of press about that. As Ms. Weatherby just said, the team formed in January 2007. We had a lot of meetings. I think this is probably the first community services trip to a developing country. And the meetings were just critical to ensure that we were all safe and that students followed the guidelines. And these students were just phenomenal. And we had no problems because they did follow the guidelines that I put in place. And I just want to mention before the students get started that as a professional educator, and as a Cape resident, I really am so proud of these Cape students. They settled right in, they started speaking Spanish, they followed many rules. I mean, there are many, many rules from just when get-go at Concord Trailways in the airport. You never go anywhere unless you're with a buddy. We had all these rules that sometimes I think you're more apt to see in an elementary school, but we had to have those rules, and they never complained, and they always followed the rules, so the students were great. They were always very positive. When the Safe Passage people asked them to do something, they did so without any questioning or no complaining. Monday morning, our first day there, right after we received classroom assignments in the morning, and students just went right off to their respective rooms and just dove right in speaking Spanish and helping out. And I really didn't see, for example, what Liz and Ben did during the week because we were all assigned to a certain area. And then in the morning when we arrived, we were up at 6:30 or 7, had breakfast. We did stay in Antigua, which is an hour from Guatemala City. Really isn't safe to say, at least in this area of the city, it's probably one of the worst areas of Guatemala City. So we'd be down at school at about 7:30, but 8 in Guatemala City. But many times throughout the week, I heard a lot of the Safe Passage personnel saying, this CAPE group is just amazing. We've never seen a service team like this. And that, to me, was just really interesting because we're in Guatemala City, and sometimes there's kind of this stereotype, oh, well, you're from Cape Elizabeth, and they had no knowledge of Cape Elizabeth. I mean, we had to explain that Maine is north of Boston, it's north of New York City. So what they were telling us is really very genuine and very, very much from the heart, that they were amazed at the students' language ability. The students were just very positive and very hardworking. So I was just so proud of the students. And one time at lunch, one of the students, I think it was Tuesday, a student came up and said, okay, now, Senora Dana, if I want to say, I want you to do this, do I need imperfect subjunctive or present subjunctive? And the Safe Passage personnel looked at me and said, if they're asking these type of questions, you know, we're all set with the Spanish. And I think one thing Safe Passage said they're thinking of doing now is, and they're having a board meeting at the end of this month, and it's just an idea of one of the personnel I spoke with, is that service teams need to have a rudimentary amount of Spanish because they realized that we were able to accomplish that much more with our students knowing the language. I mean, they really went right. There were some grammar mistakes, but they went right in and used the language. So, and I have to say, I just got a postcard from Lisa, who's one of the people we work with in Safe Passage, said, we use your great group as an example to follow for next year's groups. So on that note, I'm just going to turn it over to the students, and they'll talk a little bit about the day-to-day.
This slide shows a picture of a traditional house that many of the kids would probably live in. It's a little different than most of the houses that we live in here in Cape Elizabeth. And in that one little house, maybe 20 family members might live, maybe 7 or 8 kids, along with grandmothers, aunts, and assorted other family members, probably with a single mother.
It's important to know first, that while we were there, we worked primarily in two different places. We worked in the main building, which was 4 children in grades kindergarten through about 8th grade. And then Liz and I worked about 2 city blocks down from there in the Guarderia, which was like a daycare center, which was put in a couple years ago because these young mothers needed a place for their little children to go. So while we were there, it was important for us to understand that Safe Passage wasn't actually a school for these children, but it was a place for them to learn and to grow as a child outside of the male nourishment that's in their families and in their schools, because obviously they don't have the best resources there where they live. So when we were there, we had to make sure that we were doing as much to help these children and let them grow on their own and not forcing them into the ideas that might be surrounding them in their homes and their city.
This is the dump where a lot of the children's parents work. And before Safe Passage, many of the children had to either go work in this dump or help babysit their younger siblings at home. And it's now illegal for children under the age of 14 to enter the dump. However, it's still done because there are not extremely strict rules and it's pretty easy for people to sneak children in. But Safe Passage offers another place for these kids to go rather than having to spend their day in the dump.
This is the Guarderia where Liz and I worked. And like I said, this was the smaller children. And the people at Safe Passage really stressed to us about how important it was for us to be role models for these children while we were down there, because these children had a lot of male nourishment at home and their lives just weren't in the sort of place where they could grow up to be people that we might like them to be. On the other hand, all these places are obviously trying to help them, and all these kids are just so grateful for everything that we're doing for them. And it's just an amazing experience to be able to interact with these children.
Yeah, and we brought Frisbees down, and we were teaching the kids how to play Ultimate, which is a pretty popular game here around Cape, and they really loved it, and they had never seen Frisbees before, so they got a really big kick out of that.
The last picture quickly was the clinic that they had at the school, just one of the many things that they've put in to help the children. But the rest, most of these pictures show how grateful and how happy these children were despite their living conditions. And that's Emily McDuffie in the picture. And that was part of her class that she worked with while she was there. These are first graders. And all of these children couldn't read yet, and they're just starting to really learn the things that they need for their life. And yet they're still so happy to be with other people. And even if you can't speak Spanish, they're happy that you're there and you're trying to help them.
Um, This is lunchtime in the Commodore, and the children receive 2 meals a day generally. And that's a really big help to them, because at their house they might not have significant amounts of food and they might be malnourished. So it's very important that they get the 2 meals a day at the Guarderia or the Commodore.
This is also the Commodore, but this is at the Guarderia with the younger children. And they serve them 2 snacks and a lunch every day because of their life at home.
While we were there, we helped the kids make soy yearbooks, where we interviewed them and then helped them make a book with a picture of themselves on the cover. And we brought down a digital camera and a printer. And they were all really, really, really excited because none of them had pictures of themselves at home. And they loved the cameras. They were always asking to borrow our cameras and loved to take lots and lots of pictures.
We all really love this picture. It was actually suggested by the man who was, this is
Julio.
He was a first grade teacher, and they, Caitlin and Katie were in charge of the soy yearbooks, and Julio decided that he wanted to take a picture with them showing the connection between these U.S. students and the students in Guatemala and how they felt about each other. So he decided that they would take a picture like this.
This is meal time over at the Guarderia, and a lot of the kids don't have very good eating skills yet, so we had to help feed them.
Again, everything that was down there was just so amazing to be with these kids and to be able to play with them, especially at the Guarderia, where they had a lot of time just for them to play and be out of their homes. And everything that we did was just such an amazing experience to remember.
They love to climb all over everyone since we had lots of time to play with them, and they might not get a lot of that at home because they might be one of several children and their parents are very busy. So they love having hugs and playing with all of us.
This is, again, one of the things we donated was the Frisbees, and you can see how he's holding the Frisbee upside down, which was just amazing to see that they had never seen something like that before. The Guarderia again. Liz was saying she worked with the really young kids about ages, a couple of years. And a lot of the mothers that dropped their children off and picked their children up from school were actually younger than we were, or about the same age. The first day that we got there, Rosie Weinberg was with a little boy, and she asked him, "Do you have any siblings? What are their names? What are their ages?" And he told them, and she was expecting the same answer, the same question in return, and the boy asked if she had any kids. And she was just really surprised by that whole idea that we really wouldn't think of here.
We helped pack food bags because as part of the program, since the children are not able to work since they attend Safe Passage, in exchange for each child that you send to the program, you receive a food bag that has basics such as flour, sugar, salt, beans, little packs of needles, and we had to help pack all these things from the huge sacks into smaller cases and separate them into bags so that they could have pretty much the food that their family needs for the month.
That whole idea was what our trip was about. And the last day that we were there at the project, all the families came to receive their food bags. And everything about that day summed up our whole trip, because all the families were thanking us for being there along with getting their bags. But you could also see what life is like there. And there were only 3 fathers that were there the whole day, along with all the mothers of the children. And they had the fathers stand up, and they asked them questions like, what is your child's name, what is their age, and what grade are they in? And if they got these questions right, they actually gave them an extra prize. And a lot of the fathers couldn't do that. And that whole day, just the gratefulness and all the things that we wouldn't even think that might be able to happen in Cape Elizabeth really summed up our whole week in Guatemala and just what an amazing experience it was.
I guess that's it. I just hope that these 14 students grow up and kind of plant the seed. I think now we really need to stretch our boundaries in the 21st century, the global community. And I really hope that Cape residents will take this to heart, whether, you know, it's inviting an international student from either SMCC or USM to dinner one night, or I would love to see the town of Cape Elizabeth form a group to establish a sister city affiliation, maybe with a town in Central America or Africa or Asia or wherever. I just think that we need to be moving on a little bit more. So I hope that this has planted the seed for us to do that. And again, remember, September 27th will be in the Cape Community Center from 7 to 8. It will a lot more detail, and you can answer questions or ask questions, whatever. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you. Questions? Comments?
I'd just like to comment, if I can. I saw Susan late this summer, and I must say to you, I've talked to a lot of people who've gone on a lot of trips and done a lot of these things. I have never saw anyone as excited as Susan was when she came in to talk with me and talk about this, and we've talked a couple of times since. Then the first day of school, I happened to be down at the high school when Ben came along, and I had a chance to talk with him. I saw that same excitement there. And so it was an amazing experience for all of them, and I know Susan was very careful what she said, but I know she has some plans and hopes that can happen in the next couple of years for those teachers down there and also for students to visit, but also to bring some of them here to see American schools and work with them. So I really think it's important to understand that Cape Elizabeth students got very, very high praise down there for the way they reacted with the students, for their Spanish and the way they spoke Spanish, and also just by their presence. And I think it's really important to understand that and understand what a wonderful bridge they built to Guatemala this last summer. So I thank you very, very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Excuse me, update on consolidation?
Yes.
Alan?
As you'll remember, our consolidation report was due with the Department of Education by August 31st, and it did go to the department, and they did receive it prior to August 31st. Last Wednesday, we received an email from the commissioner with several questions that needed to be answered based on our 05-06 budget, and so that has been done. I would say Pauline is sitting there, and I would say it was a fairly tense few days because the 05-06 had been taken off our computer as they updated to the next year, so there was some serious searching that had to be done. And yesterday at 10 minutes of 5, before the mail truck pulled in here, we did get the report into the mail. We are supposed to hear from them as a result of this report by Friday, as far as where we are in that consolidation plan. We have, as you know, applied for consideration as a high-performing school district that also uses its finances carefully in order to maintain the school district. And we are hoping that that will be followed through. I would like to say very quickly that once we got the request from the commissioner, I contacted Cynthia Dill, who worked so hard for us in the legislature, handed the request on to her, and in one day, she contacted several people, including the commissioner, to be absolutely sure why they were asking the questions and what they meant for us. So I think it's important to know that our legislator jumped onto it very quickly and was right there to help us out in that process. So again, Friday is the 14th, and so we will be anxious to see what does come in at that point in time.
Thank you, Alan. Update regarding Hannaford Field.
What I'm going to do is Keith is coming this evening, and apparently it has not arrived yet. So if we could move down and then come back to that, I would appreciate it at this point in time.
Sure. MSMA Fall Conference. I guess the question is, we know who's going, who's not, and the question came up earlier too is, if we don't have a delegate, can we vote in absentia?
No. Trish, you sent that to me, didn't you, Trish? And I did respond to all of you, is that you must be a delegate in order to participate in the legislation piece of it. And you must, so therefore you have to have documentation to show that you're a delegate. And so for that part of it, for the voting part of the Maine School Board Association, you do need to have that piece of information. To attend conference, I think Trish and Karen, you did last year, right? You can attend. What I need to know is in advance, because we do have to pay a fee in order for that to happen. But so there are two pieces to this. To attend the conference is perfectly fine, and you are, with a fee, you will be allowed to go there. But to be a delegate, then I must send your name in by after a vote of the board, so that you can be officially recognized as a Cape Elizabeth School Board delegate and therefore have the power to vote.
And that, those are the 2 days that we have a half day of school and no school because of parent-teacher conferences. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Alan, the parent-teacher conference day and half day, is that fairly standard throughout the state of Maine, or are we, is that one of our, reflecting just our own?
I honestly can't answer that question. I don't know that it is reflected in each school system. I think that was a decision of our calendar committee this year. Trish, you chaired that. I don't think that was looked at as something that's done across the state.
No,
right?
That sort of was in the calendar, and to be honest with you, we probably should look at that differently next year.
Yeah, I mean, it's just an issue for those of us who have children who are still in schools.
I would like to add, though, that I got a lot out of it last year, and I think Trish enjoyed it. And if we do, you know, anyone who is able to make it, I would highly encourage them to. And I thought it would be wonderful to have the opportunity maybe at a workshop to just sort of give some highlights from those conferences that we, or seminars that we do attend, to let you know some of the exciting things that we learned that might benefit us as a school board.
Does anybody on the board want to be the delegate? When does the delegate have to attend? Do you know? Mary, I thought maybe you knew.
27th.
It's the Thursday, and it's I think it's just half the day, in the morning, I believe.
Morning half. Okay.
It's actually a separate question, but will we be able to sort of share the time? Like, I think you went on one day, and I don't know if I went on the same day or a different day, so that if you can't necessarily make both days, is that?
My sense is the last year, I think what we did is we paid for both days.
Okay.
I think one of you did one day and one did the next. The difference is you each didn't get a separate badge, probably. I can't remember if you did or not. But you can share the day, that's fine, as far as going in and observing and listening.
Okay. I'm unable to attend.
If we can attend, should we just email you?
Yes. We have to get the fee in. Probably
in order not to have a late fee, I believe we have to have it in by October 1st, or the first part of October.
So if you'll just email Mary, and then she will take care of the fee situation for us.
Well, we still have to vote for the delegate, correct?
If we're going to have a delegate.
Yeah.
And I would ask a question, because Kevin has been here for a while. From what I know, we have not had a delegate since I've been here anyway. But I think, Kevin, you said that there had been delegates in the past.
Yeah. I represented as the board's delegate for a few years. And prior to that, I think we had a regular, you know, there was a delegate every year. Going back to Tom Forsellen's tenure. It does take time away from the conference workshops, which is the major downside of going as a delegate. I took it on because I'd been to so many workshops that I pretty much knew what was going to be presented in each. To be perfectly honest, I don't think it's worth it if you have a choice between being a delegate or going to workshops. I don't think being a delegate is worth it. You're one of hundreds, and my observation was always that the vote was almost always unanimous. So that's my own opinion.
But I think a sideline to that, Kevin, if I'm right, though at the time that the delegates meet, there are people in workshops.
That's
so
exactly
for instance,
right.
Like the two of you could not have attended some of the workshops last year because you'd have been in the delegate.
Yeah, my best recollection is that the delegate assembly is the equivalent of two workshops and lunch.
Okay, so back to the original question. Does anybody want to be the delegate? Okay, so then we will. What we'll do is, for anybody who wants to attend at various times, I'll get back to Mary by the end of September. Mm-hmm. Let her know, and then she can fill in. Is that okay? Okay. Annual report from School Volunteer Services.
Yes.
Alan?
You have in front of you a report that Gail Schmader put together. She does this annually about volunteer services. And I want to be absolutely sure that you do understand what an extremely valuable program this is to the system. I think any of you as parents who also ended up being volunteers have had strong experience with that. If you've seen the training that she does, or anyone who does volunteering for us, is extremely important. And so Gail takes a great deal of time to put together just a summary of what she does. Yesterday, I had the opportunity to meet with Gail, along with Jane Eberly, who is one of our legislators, to talk about businesses in Cape Elizabeth schools. And in November, Jeff and Jane Eberly and Gail and I will be meeting to see how we can link up with businesses to do projects. One project I can point out right off quick is Evan Thayer is doing the robotics. He has had some support from a couple of businesses in the area, would like to really expand that, and this would offer us the opportunity to do that. So if you go through the report, and I won't go through it word by word, it's a fairly long report, but it is important for you to recognize what is in here. Gail talks about in here the community resources that we have, and oftentimes, again, going back to the meeting yesterday, oftentimes people get hung up with the fact that we don't have major businesses here in Cape Elizabeth, and therefore we don't call on those. But what we need to understand, we have major businesses represented in Cape Elizabeth by owners, CEOs, etc. And so there is a strong interest in us gathering with those. So the community services around businesses is one we really need to work with as we go along. But set that aside, the enormous amount of resources we have in this town is amazing. I am always amazed since I've been here. I was in South Portland for years. You could put out a list and perhaps get answers and perhaps not. I have seen answers to lists for community resources that just absolutely shock is the things that can come in from this community to support the education of young people. And so Gail certainly deserves an enormous amount of credit for doing that and coordinating that and making sure those are out. I noticed one of those lists just appeared the other day on the website and continue to appear. So that is an extremely important service to you. The school mentor program. The opportunity for mentors to come in and work with students, sometimes kids from other schools for the youngest students, sometimes parents coming in or grandparents to work with students and to provide mentorship programs are extremely important to our young people. We are also very cautious of the rights and safety of students. Any of you who know me know that my number one goal is that we provide every possible opportunity for education that we can. But to go along with that, we must also look at their rights and their safety. And so she does a very careful training. She does a very careful check to be sure it is safe, that the people who are coming in are doing appropriate work with our students. And that's extremely important to all of you. All of the different issues that seem to come up, and certainly in the last few days, the ones I've dealt with, are issues that I have to look at from the perspective of what is right for students, and what is right, or what adults feel is right, perhaps not in the interest of students. And Gail certainly zeroes in on that and makes sure we deal with those issues very carefully. She looks at databases in order to gather information and to show the enormous number of hours that we get from our mentors and our volunteers in the school system. And if you look at the back of the second page, you'll see the goals for 2007-2008, which include increasing volunteer sensitivity to the needs of students with learning challenges and their awareness of appropriate ways to touch students. Recruit high school student tutors for middle school students needing academic support. For the last 2 years I've gone to the high school, and the last week of school is we've honored those students. And it is just amazing the number of students who participate in that. And increase connections with mentees, teachers to provide additional support for mentors. All three very, very important pieces to the puzzle. What she has also provided for you is the number sequence, the high number of people that we have as total volunteers here in Cape Elizabeth, and then she also breaks it down by Pond Cove Middle School and High School. Obviously, as it gets to the high school, the numbers get smaller because of the age of the student and because of the needs of the student and because the high degree of work that is done at that school, but they are there and always available. She provided other pieces that provide comparisons as far as money is concerned. If we were paying these people to come in, what would that cost us? And she's done a very careful look at that. And you will see that she provides a list of community volunteers. Who are they? Where are they? What do they do? Another piece that I think some of you have seen, maybe not all of you, is when she does the career awareness thing at the middle school. That day, again, with a number of people who live in this community and in surrounding communities from South Portland and Scarborough and that area, who come in and work with our students to provide them information about the future. So I really want to be absolutely sure that it is clear that we have a solid program here. And remember, it's a 75% program. It is not 100%. She is paid to work 75% of the day. And the work that she does is just unbelievable. And so I would suggest that each of you who have not had a chance to talk with her and to let her know how much you appreciate the work she's doing, to take the time to do that, because it is extremely important work. I've known Gail for years. Gail and I started teaching together in a close-by community 40 years ago. And so I've known Gail for a long time, and she is a dedicated individual.
Thank you, Alan. And now we'll move to 6F, our addition, which is the Relocate America.
If you saw the newspaper this last week, the front page, you saw that we were a part of a survey by Relocate America, which is selling real estate. And what happened was is that Cape Elizabeth is one of 25 towns and cities across America who were recognized in that. We were the only town or city in New England that was recognized in that program. I want to take just a minute, in case people haven't seen it, to read what it says about Cape Elizabeth and Cape Elizabeth schools, because this was recognizing why it's important to relocate in Cape Elizabeth because of the quality of their schools. And the comment is that Cape Elizabeth, Maine offers an exceptional range of opportunities and choices and curriculums taught by the area's schools. High standards of requirements for basic subjects offer an exceptional range of courses for schools of their size. Numerous electives offered in technology and fine arts. Strong athletic and music programs. Reviews from former students rave that the teachers have always been willing to help, and the administration makes an effort to know every student's name. The sports teams are exceptionally competitive. The faculty is excellent, the facilities are above average, and the town itself is absolutely beautiful. Now, as you probably saw in the paper, one of the comments was, there are all kinds of surveys out there like this. But I think it is important to point out that Cape Elizabeth received that recognition. As I read the recognition, and I've looked at some emails that have come to me about it, and even some calls that I have received about Cape Elizabeth, one thing that really struck me about this is, as a community and as an educational piece to the community, it's important for us to see ourselves as a triangle of support. The students are at the top of the triangle, and that parents and staff serve in each corner of it. And that the staff is identified as the broad staff that work with students. It isn't the teachers alone. It is the administration. It is the transportation, it's the food services. Everyone plays an integral role in being sure that our students are well educated. And it is nice to know that we are recognized through this survey as a community that really does that. I will be really interested in keeping track of local real estate companies and seeing what difference that makes, if anything, as far as people moving in here into town. But it is a high honor for us. But I will add the last statement, which I saw in the Cape Courier today, in a little box. And that statement is this: we do an excellent job, but can we do more? And the answer is yes. Because until I can point to that every student in Cape Elizabeth performs at the highest levels, we have work to do. And it's fortunate we are where we are, but we also need to look at where are we going and how can we make that happen. So as citizens of Cape Elizabeth, you should all take great pride in this. As staff of the school system, we all take great pride in it. But we all know that the work is never done. And as we move ahead and continue to improve what we're doing.
Thank you, Alan. Anybody want to add anything? Okay, we'll move along to recognition.
Yes, We have three people who we would like to recognize tonight for their service and work in Cape Elizabeth. I'm going to call Steve Conley up to do the first recognition for us for a very important staff member who has chosen a better way of life. I don't know, but who has made some changes.
Got some important questions for you, buddy. No, no, this is participatory.
We know better than doing that, buddy.
I would have to say when I started in this school system back, I don't know, 26 years ago, when I first met Buddy, I never thought I'd have the opportunity to be up here doing this piece now. I'm very fortunate here, Bud, to be sharing some words here. Now, let's see. As far as I can tell, Buddy, I think you worked in the Cape Elizabeth schools for 36 years. So if I'm counting backwards, okay, from last year, I'd say that would have been like, the first year would have been like 1970, 71.
Yeah, I was 13 when I
started. That's okay, because I was in kindergarten. I figure that over the time, whether you were a self-contained teacher, which I know you did that for a while as well, and whether you're a teen teacher and so forth, that means you probably had somewhere in the neighborhood of 1,000 kids. That sound about reasonable?
Yeah, I did that math one day, too. Somewhere between 1,000 and 1,500.
Oh, okay, upwards of 1,000. And one of the really interesting things about Buddy is he could meet that student today that he had 32 years ago and tell the student who he or she was and tell you something about that person as well. Another question I have for you, Buddy, is how many principals have you had in your career?
I think the word is train.
Are they picking that up at home?
I think five.
Five?
Give or take three.
All right, so from Buddy himself, he confirms for us he's a man that has operated for the past 36 years by few principals. So, you get it, Buddy? Okay. I've got some words that I'd like to use to describe Buddy, all kidding aside. And the words that students, parents, and peers would use for Buddy are words like fun, unbelievably, great deal of fun, funny guy, very patient person, very caring person, well known for his flexibility. Something's not working right for a particular student on a particular day. Okay, we'll figure it out another way. Very creative person. Some of the projects that he had students do, some of the things that he brought in to show me to do with my students later on, and I just looked at and said, where'd you get this from? Oh, I made it up. I think he lied to me, but in any case. another key word about Buddy would be compassionate. That anybody that you talk with, if I ever said to parents, this is the configuration, and the word would go out, oh, well, you know, if you get Mr. Earle, he is the most compassionate guy. The kids are going to love him. He's going to be one of their all-time favorite teachers. So very important idea there. Now, a little bit about the humor part with Buddy. He has the most unique sense of humor, kind of twisted sense of humor that I've ever encountered in my life, and I'm going to give you a clear example of that. Back when some of the surgeries were first occurring for Buddy, and he said to me, gee, Steve, it looks like I'm going to be losing a toe. He says, but it's not all bad because I've asked my doctor if he'll save the bone for me so I can make a fishing jig out of it. And he was serious. Doctor had to tell him it would have been illegal for him to do that. So Buddy's very passionate about his fishing. He's passionate about education. He's passionate about people. He's the kind of guy who, no matter what we were doing, no matter which program came and went, no matter how many times we sat in rooms and talked about different components, whether it was data or about math or anything else, Buddy was the guy who always stopped it somewhere during the line and said, well, what does this mean for kids? What are we trying to do here? How is this going to improve what we're doing with them? So he always brought us back to the idea about students. And the other thing about him that everybody knows is he's also one of the most positive people that you could ever meet. Sometimes you feel like you're maybe not having the best day, and you're kind of down in the dumps a little bit, and Buddy comes in with a big grin, crack some joke, tell you something silly, that, and then you'd say, so how are you doing, bud? Oh, this surgery's healing up quite well. Or, yeah, I really like this one. This is a nice car here. Hey, you want to see my new birthmark? Or, I mean, you go on from one body part to the next and would just have you looking at things afterwards going, yeah, I got it pretty darn good. You know that? So always had that look, that silver lining going for himself and for other people. Great smile, too. So I'd just like to say that Buddy taught everybody at the middle school with whom he works, with the students and the families, quite a bit about being a person and not just about being an educator and not just about learning from a textbook or learning some facts. And he has left an incredible impact on a generation of Cape Elizabeth families, and we thank him for that.
The next fake leg, they're going to make an extra 2 inches, so.
That's 5'10", bud.
Kevin, it was good to see you. I see you're retiring.
Buddy.
I'm losing parts as quickly as
the problem was the vascular guy, I think he had a black market on body parts. I'm not sure.
So you know how to get out of this area.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Buddy, on behalf of the Cape Elizabeth School Board, I would like to present you this gift to remember Cape Elizabeth by, and particularly to remember one section of Cape Elizabeth, which I think was always very close to your heart. Just as a sideline, I've only been here for 2 years, but Buddy was probably one of the first people I met here. And he's kept me laughing ever since. He keeps me on my toes, but he is known as one of the very finest teachers that Cape has ever known. And I said to him today, I can't go anywhere in southern Maine without somebody saying, do you know Buddy Earle? How is he doing? What's happening with him, et cetera? So he is known not only in Cape Elizabeth, but all over the area because of the fine personality that he has and how much people care for him. So Buddy, on behalf of us, I would like to present this to you. You might want to open it. I'll stand here and help you, and Kathy.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi, Buddy.
Kathy, I remember from when she was it 14?
No.
12.
12.
We were just talking about that.
I was 12 when you started here. It was a couple years ago.
Like I said, I started when I was 13. Yeah.
I remember you'd always crack jokes. I was in the room next to your room, and the girls had to cut through your room to get to the ladies' room, and no matter when you did it, you'd be teaching a class and you'd cut some joke, you know, as you were going through and make some comment, so.
Well, there's a nice saying in it, if all you deal with teachers, and it's really true most about younger kids, and it goes something like this, they'll never remember exactly what you taught. They'll always, always remember how you made them feel.
Yep.
And that's what's made it easy. I can't say I've had a single bad day coming to work. And 10-year-olds are wonderful. They still think adults are human. So it was great. I don't know if you've all ever.
Try the swivel here.
It's especially painted.
It's a print of a.
So we figured that was your home away from home. For many years.
Yeah.
For many years.
Many years.
Yeah. Buddy, did you want to say a few words?
Just a general thank you. There's been a lot of school boards that I've been involved with, and from the school boards I've gotten support, the support from Alan and Steve this year, this last 2 years obviously has been a little more difficult, has been fantastic, and my best friend is sitting up back there somewhere, she's the other part of it too. It hasn't been as easy as I've joked, although I can now say things like, geez, guys, get the money, put your foot and get out of here. So, if you can see the bright side of everything, it makes everything a lot easier. And this foolish sense of humor that has definitely helped me. But Cape's been a wonderful place to work. All you as parents and teachers should pat yourselves on the back. Been some wonderful, wonderful families and kids. Someday I'm going to write a book, I think, All names will be anonymous, so no one has to worry. But it's just, it has, it's been a great 36 years, so thank you all.
Buddy, can I take that down back for
yes,
you?
Yes, absolutely.
As you work your way down.
Thank you, buddy.
Our next retiree could not be here this evening, but I have asked Pauline Apotria if she would just say a few words about her, and we have a gift for her which we will take back afterwards. So, Pauline, just a few words about her work in the central office.
The person that I work with that is retiring from our office is Louise Strout. Louise has been with Cape Elizabeth for 22 years. I've been here about 10 years, so when I arrived in Cape, Louise was the one that knows everything about the building, knows everything about what was going on. She was tremendous help when I first came. I think we're all sad to see her leave after 22 years. She's done a tremendous job with the school department, but also with the town, since we take care of both the school business and the town business. She does a great job. I know Mary has known her way before I came, and we will miss her.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay. And we'll make sure she gets the gift on Friday as she gets ready to leave. I'll press Thursday. We'll give it to her.
Okay.
Make sure we get her. Thank you.
So I've known her for 22 years, and I've known Buddy for 32 years.
And last, but far from least, is Kevin Sweeney. Kevin, could we get you to come up here, please?
Yes.
Kevin, it's a pleasure to be able to speak to you this evening and talk with you about your experiences as a member of the school board. You have 10 years on the school board, which in a school system is a long time. I'm sure Kevin will be the first to tell you how many superintendents he's trained. And I'm the last one he'll train, but he'll keep track of me to make sure I remember my training situation. But I think one of the best examples I can give of Kevin is when I came here. The board will remember, particularly if you're on the board, you had quite a few candidates. You did the first interview, then you did a second interview, then you did a third interview, and each time the numbers began to fall. And I was a superintendent in another community who was in that position of, do I tell the community what's going on? Do I keep it quiet? Then that announcement came that it was going to be announced to the newspapers that who the last three candidates were. And so I talked to Kevin at that point. I went to my school board in my other community and told them what was going on, but said, you know, I don't expect to be going there. I'm just letting you know. So then we went on. I talked to Kevin. He said, it'll probably be another couple of weeks. So on a Monday afternoon, I was sitting in the guidance office at the conference table with 10 people having a conference, and the secretary came in and said, there's a woman on the phone who's been trying to get a hold of you all day long. Her name is Mary Bruns. I wonder what she's calling for. So I said, okay, and they handed me the phone, and I picked it up, and Mary said, hi, Alan. Kevin wants to talk with you. So here I am sitting with the principal, the guidance counselors, and several of the teachers, and Kevin gets on the phone, and he said something to the effect of, Alan, I hope you'll make my day. And so he talked to me and he said, I want to offer you the position in Cape Elizabeth Schools as superintendent. And I can pay you this amount of money and we'll be anxious to hear what your response is. And all I could say to him is, I've got to finish a meeting and go back to my office, and then I'll call you back. And so I called him back, and at that point, we had the conversation. Because in the meantime, I had to call my wife to tell her what was going on, since she wasn't sure either. But the key to me about that entire process was the fact that Kevin valued very highly the process of having a superintendent come in. School board had gone through a really rough time a year before, and he was very clear that he wanted to be sure he had a superintendent who would come here and do the job that he or she was supposed to do. And Kevin and I sat and we talked several times about what is a superintendent in Cape Elizabeth. That opened the door for me to understand that Kevin's long experience as a school board member helped him take a look at any person who was coming in and think about what will that person offer to the Cape Elizabeth schools. And Kevin has a saying that he always quotes, and I don't know that I'm going to say it correctly, and he'll correct me when he comes up, but it is the fact that school systems and the work of boards is always focused on the student and on the young child, because they are the product that we produce. And so Kevin made that very clear. Kevin and I, during my first year here, spent a lot of time getting me caught up, because any town, you need to learn the history. I had Mary, who was the historian of the town. I had several other people, but Kevin had that picture, and he worked with it over and over again to make sure we had the steps in place. In the last year and a half, Kevin has had some health problems, which he readily admits, but he's also courageously gone back to college, is working on a degree, is trying to do all of the things that he needs to do, both for his health, both his mental health and his physical health. So a while ago, he tried to make this choice. And he came to me and we talked about it. And we talked about it from the perspective of, how do you make the choice? How do you take the history that you have and lay that aside and move on to what is best for you? I know Kevin probably won't admit it, but I know Kevin struggled with that choice and went over and over and over what he should be doing. But in the long run, and I've said this to Kevin many times, you made a choice which is best for you. And that is the important thing, that we make those choices for us at that point in time. So this evening, we honor Kevin for the 10 years he has given to the school board. But we also honor him for the leadership he's given. Kevin loves to smile and laugh, but he also loves to take somebody on if they are doing the right thing. And he'll question it, because again, his number one interest is the young people of this system. And that has come through very loud and very clear all the way through. So from my perspective as a superintendent, I wish Kevin only the very best. I've told him I will be calling him for information and advice and thoughts as we move along and as we go through the next difficult stage that we have to go through with consolidation. But I also know that Kevin can leave here knowing that we have done everything we possibly can and continue to do everything we possibly can to honor the needs of our young students. So Kevin, I want to wish you the very best. I want to thank you, and I want to thank you for your support as we've gone through this. Kathy?
I don't speak as well as Alan, so I'll be much briefer. But Kevin, it's been a very interesting 4 years that I've been on the board. We've had our ups, we've had our downs, we've had our everything's in between, but it's all been very fun. And you've always kept me on my toes. And just when I thought, I know what Kevin's going to say about that, I didn't. So I wish you all the best, and I hope you come and see us lots of times and call and, you know, when you think we're getting in trouble, I'm sure we'll hear from you. Anyway, congratulations, and I wish you all the best.
Here for budget debates.
Yes, there we go. Yes.
Did when I was on the board.
That would be
my
great.
My favorite time of year. Yes.
So,
Kathy, thank you.
Thank you.
And I'd like to say one last thing, Kevin. If you look at this gift, it's smaller than most of them, but we worked really hard at getting something that really means something to you, because you have been here through those 10 years, and you've seen many physical changes of the buildings, as well as student changes, etc. So we wanted you to have something you can put on the wall, you take the paper off, that you can put on the wall that really describes that 10 years that you've been here. Kevin.
Thank you. I kind of like the paper.
Expert wrapping.
Gee, you know, this is tougher than my first election and my first school board meeting. I really thought I'd make it to 13 years. Unfortunately, last May, my doctors said to me, Kevin, if you don't take care of yourself first, you won't be able to take care of anybody else. That was pretty sobering. And as Alan said, we spoke numerous times. In the meantime, towards during the earlier part of my health journey, so to speak, I had gone back to school. Being stuck in a dialysis chair for days on days on days, unable to move, just got me going, and I really needed to do something with my mind. And that's become a major commitment for me. I'm hoping that by this time next year, I'll be at the USM School of Social Work, continuing on as a generalist in social work so that I might be back in Cape Elizabeth as your resident social worker. But my real calling at this point is to work with renal patients in stage and post-transplant patients. I did say, Alan cleaned it up or made it sound a lot nicer than what I usually say. And I know all of you are probably bored hearing this after 10 years, but shortly after I took out my nominating papers for the first election, I wrote myself a note. It's not about you, stupid, it's about the kids. Stuck it in my wallet, and that was my motivation for my very first debate in town hall. And I've never regretted that decision, although it certainly has been an interesting journey, which some Chinese philosopher believes is a curse, and I certainly believe is a blessing. I'm not going to drag this out any longer. I certainly appreciate the opportunity the residents of this town have given me to serve their children. I've certainly enjoyed working with the faculty, one of my special constituencies. They are the most dedicated people I've run into in many a year. I've enjoyed working with all the administrators, even those that I have survived. They were always, all of them, involved, concerned, and usually knowing the names of every single one of their students. And you'll never find that, I don't think you can find that in many places other than Cape Elizabeth. The ed techs, whether they were ed tech ones or two, the cafeteria staff, the bus drivers, the janitors, have just been outstanding over the 10 years I've been here. You know, you can pick and choose your times when things didn't go quite as well as we expected, but they're few and far between. And you know, for people like me, the psychic compensation is more than worth it when you can go home at night and say, gee whiz, I just saved a reading recovery. So I don't want to leave out my colleagues on the board, particularly this group. We had a tough time a couple of years ago, really tough time. And this group has brought it all back together. There's some classy people up here, and there's one thing I can say about each and every one of them. We may disagree on methodology, but we all care about the kids. So thank you once again, and while I know I'm lecturing to the choir, it's about the kids.
Thank you. should mention there will be food afterwards in the Jordan Conference Room for anyone who would like to stop in and have some food to honor our retirees. And thank you again very much, everyone.
Thank you. I'm going to move back to 6C, the update regarding Hannaford Field. I see that Keith has joined us.
I'd like to say a few words about it first, is that with the board 2 weeks ago, I think it was, we had a discussion about the need to really get more information out and understanding about the use of Hannaford Field. I want to be very clear on where we have been. We have been on a fairly long journey with the extracurricular committee as the turf field was first planned, the funds raised, and finally it was built. We spent an enormous amount of time doing research on how people deal with these fields. We spent a lot of time looking at our own budget, our school budget, and the money that was available, and the money that was not available, and how we were going to manage this. I would thank Keith for the research he did. I know Jeff did a great deal of research for us, and so did Sue Weatherby, as we went through this process, and as we worked with the committee in order to put this information together. I think at the same time, we have learned that one of the things we did not do, and we needed to do better, was to get information out to the community. Because again, what happens with any community, with the number of people you have, there are assumptions made, and those assumptions can become incorrect and can become difficult. And so what we are going to do tonight is to spend some time talking about the updating of the Hannaford Field, where we are at this point. I talked with Keith, he agreed to do this. I apologize to him because I know he's a long trip home every night, but he said he'd be more than happy to do that. I also know that Linda Winker, who is the chair of the extracurricular committee, will also speak to it. And also I will mention that once we finish this and do the superintendent's report, then we'll do the unfinished business, which are several issues around the gate fees and around the fields itself. And the last comment I would make is this. The last couple of days have been interesting. I think this morning I sat down at my email and discovered several letters and have been sending letters out all day long. And then just before this meeting, I had several forwarded to me, which did not come to me, but came to board members and were forwarded on. So it makes it very clear that whether right or wrong, we have some information that we've got to clarify and get out to the public correctly. So again, what I've asked Keith to do is to talk about where he sees it at this point, what we are doing, what we're trying to do as we go into our first year of a very major change in our athletic program and the facilities available for it. Keith, thank you for being here.
You bet. First of all, I mentioned after today, all of our fall teams that would use the field have had games on it. I think that the kids have enjoyed it immensely. I know that the teams that have come here to play have enjoyed the facility a great deal. The scheduling of it for practices and trying to get everybody sufficient time to use it has been kind of a nightmare, but I think we are making progress as we proceed. There's no question that it's a beautiful facility and one that I think the community should be proud of, and everybody who comes and uses the facility enjoy it a great deal. The problems with the field, other than everybody wanting to use it all the time for everything, the basic problems have come from how we're going to pay for the things that we need in order to have contests at night. We have had two girls soccer games in the evening, we've had one field hockey game, and we had a football game on last Saturday afternoon. I think as we have proceeded from the beginning through each one, I think things have gotten better and better. Last Saturday, we had a very good attendance at the first home football game, and we had a minimum number of problems. The police chief and I talk every Monday about the previous activities and changes that we make. We have cut back on the police officers that we need. for the various games. There were four at the football game. We're going to have three at the next. The first night there were three at the soccer game, girls' soccer game. There'll be one there from now on. We haven't had a boys' soccer game at night, which there'll be two. And the other field hockey games, there'll be one. So we make these adjustments as we go along because we're learning what we need to do and how we can run efficiently, and we're making these constant adjustments. And as I said, we're learning as we go. Again, as I said, the games have been terrific there. The kids have enjoyed it. Everything there has gone. That part of it has gone extremely well, and I think if we make it through the fall season, we're learning as we continue to proceed here, and I think people have to realize that we'll make these adjustments as we go on. I would try to answer any questions any of you may have about our use of that facility.
Well, I just have one question because it's a little confusing as to when is the appropriate time to ask questions, because we do have two policies that are up for votes this evening that relate to this issue. So is it better to hold off our conversations for those policies, or do we get into it now under communications?
Well, I guess it probably depends on what the question, if it's something maybe more directed at Keith in the use of the field versus gate receipts at admission. So, I mean, you could do it either way, but I don't know if, well.
I think that makes sense.
Is that? Questions for Keith?
Well, just a clarification. I know we had a lot of discussion in extracurricular as far as the amount that we're going to be charging for fees and when the fees are going to be charged, et cetera. Because I know I was at one of the weekend games for field hockey.
First weekend, yeah.
The first weekend games for field hockey. And there were admission being charged for the varsity games. They started them at halfway through the JV game. And again, I think it's one of the clarifications that I can clearly see that needs to be made as far as when fees will be charged and how much fees will be charged. And I know we had long discussions in extracurricular as far as how much we were going to charge. I've seen some questions from, you know, community members as far as how much we're charging. If you could. I honestly don't remember which schools you had contacted so that we could get a good background for what.
Well, I think I think it varies various places. I think about any place you go for a football game, they either charge $5 and $2 or $4 and $2 most places. I think all of our area surrounding schools here right in our vicinity all charge at least $4 and $2. Some might, I mean, there are different things charged in different places. And in the extracurricular committee, when we discussed it last year, that was what I'm doing is the recommendation that came out of that committee for us. So, I mean, I was just trying to follow what we recommended to happen.
Right. So you're not, but that's, I guess that was just clarification I wanted made public that, I mean, we did check around to several area schools and try to get a feel for what other schools were charging for similar use.
Question. I'm sorry. Did you want to go?
I guess I'm sort of in the same predicament sort of as Rebecca, just to follow up on that. Should we talk about this now or should we wait?
May I make a suggestion? Because I know we have people from the public here. So. Can we consider this a go to the policies DFDR and KFR so we can have this conversation and hear from the public about this?
Does anybody object to that?
No.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
All right. So do you want to go
with? So I think that maybe, Trish, you need to introduce these policies and somebody can make a motion.
To put the policy on the table. The policy that we're referring to is DFD-R, which is a new policy, and it's entitled Gate Receipts and Admissions Regulation. I move that the school board approve this policy as presented. Our first reading was in June, so if we approve the policy, then it will stand. So I put on the table the motion that the school board approves this policy as presented.
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussion.
Okay. Do we want to hear from the public first about this?
Should we talk?
Yeah, okay. That's fine. That was at the end, but that's okay.
Thank you. My name is Grace Cliff. I live at 82 Ocean House Road, and I'm currently the president of the Soccer Boosters at the high school. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for 20 years. My first house was on Farm Hill Road, which is the street right behind the new Hannaford Field. When my twins were little, we used to walk up to the Under the Light games on Friday nights because they had coaches that volunteered on Saturday morning to coach them, and we used to go up and see them play. It was truly a great community gathering. A few years later, I saw my daughters play their very first varsity game on that same field. They were sophomores and had been called up to play varsity that game. We were playing York, got ahead 4-0, and they got to play their last 15 minutes there. It was just amazing, and it was exciting. My youngest daughter was 5. Fast forward 10 years later, and the lights are back on, and my 15-year-old is now a sophomore playing soccer. We have this incredible, beautiful turf field that so many people, you, Keith, the community has worked very hard and volunteered for. I don't think that there's a person whose child is playing sports that didn't do something to help get the turf and the lights back on. The first Friday night the girls played was very exciting, and you could really just feel it in the air. I saw old faces of parents whose now grown children played with my daughters back in the 90s. We, the Boosters, sent out massive emails inviting the Casco Bay Travel Soccer Kids and Saturday Morning Soccer Kids. We said, come out and see where you will play when you're in high school. And come out they did. We had kids there as neighbors there, just whole blocks and blocks of families that came. And then the issue of the gate fee. A few weeks before, Keith had asked to have a meeting with some representatives for Boosters, and we sent Martha Palmer, who's the former president of Boosters, and Martha Kelly. Keith told us of the gate fees that the extracurricular committee had voted on, and he was enforcing them, and he also asked us to handle the gate fees that night. We all thought the fees of $4 and $2 were a little steep, but we're told by Keith and by various people that different board members contacted that we were going to start out with 3 police and then 2 police and 1 police and go down. What we never got an answer to was when would that then adjust the fees? So opening night, we had 2 volunteers, and they took so much verbal abuse, it was ridiculous. People just walked by them. People said, I'm not paying, I helped build this field. People strongly objected to having pay for the JV games, because in most communities, ours included, back when we used to have a field that had the lights under it, we would start charging about halfway through the JV games. We heard a lot about charging for children. We heard a lot about charging for families. And of course, this came on the heels of the meeting before, of the, you know, annual meeting before, where people had paid $125 for our kids to play, and people had just felt like they had enough. I get over 27 emails, not from just the high school, from the middle school parents and from elementary kids who we had invited to come play and see this great thing, and they were like, you know, there's 2 parents, there's 4 kids, I mean, this gets to be expensive. The people from away were just as angry. Most of them didn't come with money. They had never been charged here. We got comments like, well, of course, you're the rich town and we have to pay. And my all-time favorite was, a man from York said, you don't charge me a dime to go to Fort Williams with a spectacular view, but you want my wife and I to pay $8 to see your new turf? I don't think so. So people called me, they emailed me. I didn't have an answer. I didn't know why. As far as we know, and I've called around to the boosters, nobody from boosters was asked to be a part of this and our response and what we thought. We don't know that boosters should be collecting the gates. We don't know how that money should be divided or where it goes to. And I know there's expenses that come up and lights and the police. And I know that we're all in the new stages of this and it has to work itself out. I'm just asking you to really look at some different things. I did call around today and get high schools. South Portland is $3, $2. Scarborough is $3, $2. Greeley is $3, $1. Falmouth, $3, $1. Gorham, $3, $1. Almost every school, with the exception of South Portland, does offer to the high school students, if they come with their high school ID, free admission as well. We've had a lot of suggestions of family passes or a booster pass. We've had senior citizen discounts, letting the kids who come from grade school get in for free. So it's a big picture. It's a fabulous, fabulous facility. And the games that have been played there, the 3-4 we've gotten, are just wonderful. And I want to thank the community for doing it. But I really would like to see this opened maybe more for discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. Oh, thank you. Is there somebody else from the public that would like to speak since we're on that mode right now? No? We can't hear you from back there, if you wouldn't mind. That's okay. You wouldn't know. We can hear you, but they can't hear you out there.
My name's Martha Palmer. I am also a soccer booster. Last year I was chair of the soccer boosters, and I was also on the committee that built the turf field and raised money for the lights. Katie has summed up really what our issues are. I was the one actually collecting gate fees. There were also some positive comments about the field along with the negative comments, and I don't think the overall atmosphere is entirely negative. It's just confusing. And the people who collect the gate fees are the people who get the questions and who get the comments. I guess it's more important for me to understand exactly what your policy is, why you're collecting the amount that you're collecting, where it goes, how often that policy might be looked at and changed, so that when people do ask us questions, we have the right answer. Because I feel like it's very confusing. A lot of people in the community don't know. I had people saying Mike McGovern is the one who set this policy. No, it was Mr. Weatherby. No, it was Mr. Shedd. I felt very confused about what I should say. So Katie summed up our need for valid information about the policies. I don't have any particular complaints about the fees, except that I think they may be a little bit high, too. But I urge you to include the boosters groups and the community when you make the decisions about how much to charge, how to charge it, who's going to collect those fees. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. The comments. Trish?
A couple comments. I agree that the issue needs to be clarified and discussed. Reiterate that. I guess my question is, what is the right mechanism for that? Is it the extracurricular? Is it policy? And I guess sitting here thinking, and Martha's comments are very good, and sort of reading through the policy, my question is, I guess, is a fee structure, should it be an addendum to the policy or part of the policy? And if it's an addendum, if it's part of the policy, then that discussion might happen in the policy committee, which is open to the public. My gut feel is that we don't want a rate schedule in a policy. We want it as an addendum, so that discussion would not take place in the policy committee. My initial reaction is that the discussion should happen at extracurricular, this would be my suggestion or my opinion, I guess I should say. At the extracurricular, revisiting all of the suggestions which we have, and some of them I think are very interesting, and then the extracurricular then makes a recommendation back to the board, and all of that is open to the public.
I would just add that, Trish, I think that's a good idea. And I would just add that when this would happen, that extracurricular contact the boosters and invite them to come, informing them of when the date and time is, so we know for sure that we've reached out to those the people with vested interest in this process.
I would agree with what Rebecca is saying, and just looking over this wonderful MSMA thing that you just sent us on written policies and how in developing policies you want to make sure that you include all the groups that are affected by those proposed policy. I mean, I do think this is a good example of being proactive and getting that feedback so we don't get to this place.
And I think those are all good suggestions. I think the one point we also need to make, and I need to make it for Keith, is that if you'll remember correctly, when we were in the budget season, Keith had built many of these things into budget. And I had to cut several of them, including police coverage, and amount of police coverage we had, some of the pieces to the field, et cetera, because our budget was so tight. And so that is another piece that we need to look at, because I have called other towns too. Because I know budget, I ask the questions about their budget. And I know how differently some towns pay for their athletic programs than CAPE has ever done. We have probably the largest number of athletic programs of any community this size in Southern Maine. But we also have booster clubs who pay for a lot of those programs or parts of those programs. And I'm very cognizant of that as we work our way through. In the budget season, I found it very difficult. As you remember, Keith gives a very, very detailed account where every cent needs to go. And we looked at that, and we cut several thousand dollars out of that budget because we knew we didn't have the money to pay for all of the pieces to the school system. I've got to get a few more pieces. To the school system. And so we had to cut those. So I think an issue that we need to, that the board, whether it goes to the extracurricular committee or the policy committee, is that we also need to look at that bottom line as far as what do we have, because it isn't easy to compare when you're comparing apples to oranges as far as what money is available. So we need to use that. And I'm not going to sit here and blame anybody for the lack of funds. That's not my job here to do. But I know we had that lack. And so that's a major issue for the board to keep in mind as we work our way through. And I also will say that, and I think Linda will support me on this, and anyone who's a member of Peter and any member of that committee, is that what we have done is we don't know exactly how much those lights are going to cost us. We don't know exactly what protection we need. We know that we need protection. We know that if we go to the other end of the scale and we have a team in there and parents get into a fight, students get into a fight, a group of kids get out, start drinking and traveling the roads, and we have an accident, we know that if we haven't had the coverage because the public has said we don't need it, and we have that problem, it will still land in our laps. And so we need to look at all of those balancing pieces and how we go about it. And, you know, I was a teacher, an administrator for 30 years in a community next door to us, and I know I watch some of the problems that arise over there and what we need to do. So we are truly in a learning stage here and trying to figure out what we need and how we need to do it. We look at, and I'll use football as an example, although I don't consider football, just because I don't consider it a violent sport all the time. We have different people and different towns we compete with. And based on who we're competing with and the level of anxiety about the game, that will bring about a difference in what we need for coverage. I've heard discussions about girls' soccer and saying we don't need that, but you never know. You never know what's going to happen in that process. So I think what we need to be well aware of as we relook at this is all the pieces to the puzzle and how those all come together to make decisions.
Yeah, Rebecca?
Alan, I think you raised a really good point that I had wanted to raise myself but forgot, which was to say that indeed the whole issue around charging gate fees came up during the budget process, because we have been under a spending cap for 3 years and we were facing programming cuts this year, and we were told when the turf field was presented that this would not impact the school budget, And it turned out, in fact, that it was, because we have to maintain the field, and we have to pay for the electricity, for the lights, et cetera. The first part of my comment would be to all the citizens that contacted us regarding gate receipts, very few of them were in contact with us during the budget process. So I suspect that perhaps they weren't aware of what we were facing. And I would urge them to perhaps stay informed this coming year and participate and let us know as a board where your priorities are in terms of where our monies go. Because if it doesn't go to the lights, or if it does go to the lights, then it will probably come out from somewhere else. My second comment, Alan, is to say that I don't think, for myself personally as a board member, I don't question the decision-making process that the extracurricular committee went through, or that Keith and Alan, you went through. But I do think that it shows me that perhaps we could have done a better job in terms of involving groups that were going to be placed in the middle of the implementation of the decision. And it put them in a very difficult and uncomfortable position. They, as you heard this evening, sounds like they were really much put on the front line without much information to help them respond. So I look at inviting them to the extracurricular committee meeting to kind of look at this again as an opportunity to first help them understand the financial underpinnings of this decision to charge gate fees, and also to get some new and fresh ideas about how we can maybe make this equitable for and more comfortable for people involved.
And I think you're right on target with that, and I would also say to you, and Keith and I have been in contact about this, we do have a new policy, another new policy coming up, which requires that the superintendent meet with the booster organizations, or at least the leaders of the booster organizations, at least 3 times a year. And the notices, I don't know if it's gone out yet or not, but I know the first meeting will be on September 27th. And there will be a notice go out to all of the booster organizations to meet with me and Keith as we go over both the policies and the process. And I think from this point on, we will be looking at it for several different purposes, because we do need to look at budget. Those of you who have been watching the newspaper and watching what's going on in Biddeford, very much aware of the fact that we need to be more specific about how funds are raised. Number two, we need to be more specific about how the accounting is done. And number three, for the information's sake, to make sure that's out. And so that first meeting will be coming up, and I know Keith and I have corresponded about it and set that as a date, just because it was one where each of us did not have a calendar that was so full we couldn't do it. So we will be doing that. So Rebecca, I agree with you wholeheartedly, and that again, the learning process is that we are going to have to do that, and going to have a different type of conversations during the year about how we work together with booster clubs.
Kevin?
I'd like to suggest to the board that there is no impediment to passing this policy tonight. Since the policy does not speak to specific dollar amounts, nor does it speak to responsibilities for collecting gate fees, or any other of the other issues that Katie has raised in her presentation tonight. So that policy is fine. What I would recommend to the board and to both the policy and extracurricular chairs is that probably what needs to be developed, since we are on a learning curve, is an administrative guideline that does not require multiple readings in order to be changed. It provides us with significantly more flexibility in making changes as practical situations become understood. So that's it from my point of view.
I guess my only question is, in reading it, the one I tend to agree with you, Kevin, which is sort of my point. However, number three on the policy, which discusses admission, says admission shall be charged for all night and weekend events on the turf field for hockey games and for basketball games. I'm wondering if we at least need to either rediscuss or specify whether that's varsity or junior varsity in the body of the policy. I'm also wondering if there needs to be a little bit more clarification, and the funds are going into a special revenue account, but it is dedicated to the athletic programs and the costs associated with running those programs. I'm not sure our verbiage, based on the comments that have been raised, is clear enough.
And that's certainly a good point, although it was always my impression from my work on the Joint Town School Board Committee and the prior financial work that I did on the field, was that any night game would be subject to a fee. Something may have changed, but that's my recollection.
Linda?
First of all, I'd like to thank all of the citizens that wrote in, because I very much appreciate the detail that you put in your emails. Going forward through the extracurricular committee, I have to tell you, it's going to make our job a lot easier. At least we know what we want to address. So first of all, I would like to thank you. We don't sit here and take this as strictly as criticism, because, believe it or not, we were expecting it. We sat right in our policy discussions. We needed to get something down on paper. We needed to start with something and start building from there. We knew that we were going to go through changes. We were trying to keep ahead of the construction of the turf field, and I have to tell you, that was not an easy thing to do. We had several policies to review that were affected by the turf field. We have policies tonight that will be going for a second reading that are already being changed as we are talking. So first, I'd just like to tell you, we more than welcome suggestions and ideas, not only from the booster groups, but from citizens. One thing in the policy I really would like to make clear, because there was one thing that seemed to come very, one voice that came out from a lot of the citizens here, was charging senior citizens. And I will tell you, in the policy, it does specify senior citizens will not be charged. We were all very specific about that, and we set our policy along with those of community services, that persons 65 and older shall be permitted to attend all activities free of charge, just to let you know that. We've had discussions about younger children and so forth. And again, our policy doesn't get specific as far as what fees are charged and all that. We do agree that, you know, maybe we do need to put a guideline along with this policy to kind of specify. Again, we were looking to put some guidelines out there so that those folks, you know, Keith, Sue, the site supervisors, the coaches, the booster organizations, at least there were some guidelines for some of these folks to get the events up and running and going on the field. Our intent was not to try and, this is not a real big money-making situation, believe it or not. Part of the gate fees will go to cover the costs involved with running the field. We were also hoping that there would be monies above and beyond those expenses that will go back to the specific sports. So those events that attract a lot of people are going to have money going back to those specific events to help support those, you know, those events. To try and turn this around and make it, you know, give you a little bit of a positive light on the admission fees. All of the accounting will be, you know, as far as the rules are concerned, you know, all the monies will be run through for the athletic events through Keith to the special revenue account. The expenses will be paid. It's not going to be an immediate type of thing, but we are looking to help support some of our programs where we can't support them in our school budgets. It will be a supplemental type of support and might, just might, actually lighten the burden on some of the booster organizations. Of course, with that may come the cost that we may need some help. It is a give and take situation, but again, I just wanted to let you know that we are reading your comments. We are taking them seriously. I really do appreciate the detail that you put into them, because it does, believe it or not, it's making it easier. Going forward, we weren't looking to exclude you. Again, it was one of those situations that we were trying to keep ahead of a project that was that already had months leeway, you know, a head start on us. So, again, thank you. And
Peter.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to just repeat what Linda said about the emails we received. I encourage you to continue to email the board on this matter. I was not offended by any of the criticisms. I find your emails very, very interesting to read, much more interesting to read than what we normally receive from our superintendent. And I say that about any citizen contact we have. It's, you know, when I open my email in the morning at work, I say, good, somebody's complaining about something. It's interesting to read. And your recommendations and your concerns are always valuable. I much rather quickly review, I mean, I print them all out and keep them in a notebook. I like to review them from time to time because it's difficult as a board member to get down to the street level and listen to you. You are very busy, we're very busy. It's hard to do. The communications does break down often, so communicate with us as often as you want. I will never be offended, and I encourage you to do so. As far as revenues go, I mean, Michael McGovern last night at the town council meeting mentioned that real estate taxes cannot be looked upon as a future source of increased revenue because property valuations are dropping, for one, because of what's going on with the national economy and housing values. Excise taxes, there are a move in this coming legislature to lower them and decrease them and exempt some of them. You know, there's another Pelsky or Tabor bill coming forward this coming year. It's going to make it hard for us again. We're either going to have to defeat it or live with it. In either case, we're going to be pressured to lower cost. There's a move to repeal school consolidation, which is supposed to save the state some money. It's being started down east and is gaining momentum. In regards to my sympathy with booster groups, Graham Smith at the field committee meeting, which is very different, the Hanneman Field Committee is very different from the extracurricular committee, but he mentioned that the town of Cape Elizabeth is tapped out, whether it be real estate taxes, personal income, funding through boosters, all the money that was raised for the turf field, the dugout committee, the Nordic Trail Committee. I mean, if you went and knocked on somebody's door in Cape Elizabeth tonight and said, I'm raising money for something, you'd be had that door slammed in your face. And for good reason, we're tapped out. We're a little tired. So for a while, revenue is going to be difficult, which is one of the reasons why the extracurricular committee said we have some expenses which haven't been funded by the school board budget because of our restrictions placed on us. We had to come up with some money somewhere. And so it is gate receipts. And as far as the policies and decisions that have been made, no one in the school committee, staff, faculty, or school board member has any experience whatsoever in managing a turf field. We tried to find some of that information, but the oldest turf field in the area is Fitzpatrick Stadium, which is really only about 5 years old, and that's funded heavily by city revenue and also by rental revenue. Nobody else had any ideas either. So we were operating in the dark, and we established policies and procedures with no knowledge, with no history, and in some cases, it's obviously been proven we were wrong. But we knew that when we did it, and we knew we would have to adjust it. And I've apologized if we have offended anybody with fees. I've heard some comments myself. But again, put them in an email and send them to us. We need your help, because we ourselves don't have any knowledge. We really, I will be the first to admit, don't know what we're doing. But continue talking to us, because it's the best emails we receive, and we urge you to continue, no matter what the subject. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
So I have a procedural question. I just noticed there's a dash R at the end of this, which means it's actually guidelines. It's not a policy. It does not require second readings. So I'm just going to assume it never has made it through its first reading. We keep changing it. But so that's the good news, is that it will not have to go through, in the future, it won't have to go through multiple first and second readings. It just has to be revised once and approved once. I would like to ask if somebody has DFD on their possession.
I think I do.
And how much different it is from DFDR. Because I think if this is a guideline, then it might be okay to insert some more specific language than we had been originally discussing.
Yeah. Does anybody else have anything before we move on? Does anyone else have anything different to say than what we already heard? I just want to add, I'm not going to repeat what people have already said because I already agree with them, but I would like to just thank Keith Weatherby and Sue Weatherby and Jeff Shedd for dealing with some of the issues that have come up with the turf field. We have this beautiful turf field. as Linda said, we've had to work very quickly and moving very fast, trying to enjoy it, protect it, figure out how we're going to deal with it. And I know that the public doesn't realize, but we've had some security issues. We've had some abuse issues. And these folks have jumped up and run out, taken care of them, and gone back to their job, and jumped up and run out and take care of them. And I just want to thank them for that, because I know that was above and beyond what they planned on doing for their first few days of school and so forth. So I won't add anything more. We do have a motion on the table. Trish, you made it. If you would like to send this back to committee, it would be you're called to table it, table your motion, and make a new one.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. And where are we sending this? Do we know?
Extracurricular.
Sending it back to?
Probably to extracurricular, which then.
Sorry, Linda.
Okay, so the motion is to table the initial motion and send it back to extracurricular, and we've got a second from Kevin. Is there any additional discussion?
Just one point, Kathy.
Oh, yes.
If we send it back to extracurricular, what are we going to do about gate receipts in the meantime? We have games coming up. What are we going to charge, and who are we going to charge, and who's going to collect it?
Is that your question, Keith?
Correct.
Alan, would you like to jump in on this?
Well, from the perspective of what we're doing right now, it is set because of what the extracurricular committee gave for information. So I think our choice is we continue what we're doing until it has been reviewed and decided, or we stop charging, which then will put us in that box of deciding, can we pay our bills?
And if we stop charging, can we start again? That's a political football I don't want.
No, that's my fear, too.
Can I ask a question about what we're charging, though? Because I sort of feel like I'm hearing two different things. I'm hearing 4 and 2, 4 and 2, 5 and 2, and then I'm hearing 3 and 1, 3 and 1, 3 and 1. So I'm just trying to make sense of what are the other schools around charging. And so do we just come up with 4 and 2 to cover our expenses more? Or?
I'll speak to that, and Keith, you correct me if I'm wrong. We had several discussions about what was needed. We looked at the average of what's being charged. What we receive for an average is $4 for adults, $2 for students. We also did have the discussions about senior citizens, who I might add I would consider perhaps at 60 and older, but that's neither here nor there. And perhaps there are some other issues that go along with that. But right now in Cape Elizabeth, for the night games and for the weekend games, I hope I'm right on that, we are charging $4 for adults, and 2 for students. We have not done at this point in time anyway, what I think you mentioned, the card that lets you in if you're a student and you have the card. I don't think we have done anything officially about the senior citizens, but that could be done in order to make that happen.
It's actually in our proposed.
Yeah. In the proposed.
In the proposed,
but
it says.
As of the last game I went to, which was Saturday, I think we were charging everyone. Am I correct about that? We did. We weren't. Were we looking at seniors?
I don't think they were in the proposal.
Okay. Okay. So, and I don't know, but it basically has been $4 and $2.
Do we want to do anything for large families? Because you are talking about a lot of money when people are coming up with four young children.
But I think that's, you know, those are the pieces of the puzzle that we need to work our way through. I don't think it's a decision we can make just tonight. We've got to look at all the possibilities.
Yeah, I think we've got to send that back to the committee because there's all kinds of potential.
Right.
I think, Linda, you had mentioned that there's all kinds of potential scenarios, and how is that going to be handled? And we can't have that long discussion here. Keith?
Just what we're doing is the same thing that we've been doing for 50 years at basketball games. We begin charging before the JV game. Many of the people who come to the JV game stay and watch the varsity game. We charge anybody who's of school age. We do not charge kids who are not in school. We have had special rates for senior citizens or not charging for senior citizens. So basically what we're doing is the same thing we've been doing forever at basketball games. Nothing different.
Hockey games as well?
Yes.
I suspect that the reason why this is particularly irksome to some citizens is that a great deal of money was donated to build the turf field. And so, whereas perhaps, you know, one would say you also did that for the basketball floor, et cetera, but it's because such a large amount of money was raised, I think we're, you can see where the resistance would come from. I think it's understandable, but Keith, you raise a very good point that this, we have been charging. It's just, we haven't been charging for something that was raised privately from our citizens to build.
Well, we need to make a decision of how we're going to let Keith proceed until the committee is able to work out all the details. Go ahead.
Could I just ask a point of clarification? Who is it, the boosters that are collecting the fees at the basketball games? Is it booster volunteers that are collecting the fees at the
We have, I'm fortunate that I have a person who is willing to do that. We have not had anybody who's willing to step forward to do handle games down there, so I asked the boosters, and at the same time, we'll pay them for that so that they can we'll get some money out of it. And by the way, Patricia, thanks for your help with the cross-country meet the other day.
Can we just make sure that whomever is collecting, it sounds like you have someone doing that, that there is complete clarity as far as who is being charged? Like the senior citizens, I hope were not charged. It sounds like they might have been charged. So to make sure whomever is in charge of those gate receipts. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Sue?
Just as a matter of clarification, at the extracurricular committee, we did bring up a family fee. We did bring up reduced fees for people who may even qualify. It was just too much to get in place too soon. So on the onset, we said, let's keep it simple. We'll charge $4 and $2. And as Keith said, we've been doing it forever. When we had night soccer games, when we did have lights years ago, they always charge for the night games to help cover the costs of the service fees.
I'd like to just make a suggestion that we continue on with what we're doing right now, which is $4 for adults, $2 for students, seniors 65 and older are free, until it can go back to committee and it can be worked out. I'm not saying that this is a permanent solution. I'm saying we need to make a suggestion tonight, send it to committee, and keep moving forward because we don't want to spend a whole lot more time on this tonight as a full board.
And this will be only for night and weekend contests.
Right, and night games are 5:45 and after. Is that correct, Keith? 5:45 and after.
I think that's in one of the policies you're going to be doing tonight.
I think so. Is that?
It is.
Yeah. Does anybody have an objection to doing that for now?
No, I think that's a good way to go, Kathy, particularly in view of the fact that there is no money in the budget to address these costs.
Right, and you know, I think of it as you know, I know people have given a tremendous amount of money for this field, and I understand being a parent that I've shelled out a lot of money for my child to play sports. But I equate it to building a house. You know, when you build a house, that's not the end of your expenses. You still have to pay for the electricity and the oil and the maintenance and so forth. And you know, the board and the school department is charged with having to continue to maintain that field. And again, this is just a temporary until the committee can go back to, until it can go to extracurricular, go to policy, and then come back to the full board.
Yes. I support that. I'm wondering, in a spirit of compromise, if we might specify that it's only varsity games and not JV games.
Comments? Thoughts?
I just go back to the budget issue.
Chief may not say it, but I think the limit that presents is right, depending on whether the JV game comes first or the varsity game comes first. After a JV game, you have to clear the entire field before the beginning of the varsity game. Now, maybe it's sort of a halftime at the JV game or whatever, but I would suggest that that's sort of in the same neighborhood of let's keep it the way it is, and it's just consistent with what's been done.
I withdraw the suggestion.
It does create some logistical issues.
I withdraw the suggestion.
One last question. Last year at basketball games, how much did we charge?
I think it's $4 and $2.
3 and 1.
3 and 1. Okay.
Last year.
And this year?
This year will be whatever the school board decides.
Thank you, Keith.
So,
ask a question. Why are we going up?
Okay, can I? We're going around in circles.
Yes.
I appreciate that we need to do something, and I appreciate Kathy setting it forward. Based on Keith's rationale, which I support, until we can walk it through the process and factor in what people have suggested, which are great suggestions, I would like to further suggest that we do what we've been charging for basketball, and that's 3 and 1 and free for citizens, senior citizens, until such time as we can work out the details. For JV and varsity.
Okay, let's do this like we're having a real meeting. Would somebody like to second that? Heaven?
Wait, and we haven't even voted. Did we vote on the first
one? She voted to table it.
She tabled.
She tabled.
And we don't need to vote as a. Sorry, you guys.
She tabled.
The motion to table was never voted on.
The motion to table was never voted
on? Right.
Okay, we'll back that one up. Does anybody want to discuss the motion to table? All in favor of tabling? Okay, now, I think I lost it.
Second Trish's motion.
Yes.
I will.
Okay.
Could Trish repeat her motion,
Trish,
please?
Trish, can you repeat your motion?
It was a long one, but basically I move that until such time as we can finesse our policy and our fee structure, that we charge $3 for adults, $1 for students, in keeping with what we are currently charging at basketball games for both varsity and JV.
For night games.
For night and weekend games.
Night and weekend games. Games starting at anything at 5:45. All right. Kevin, you seconded that, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, I did, and I seconded again.
Well, thank you.
Clarification.
Discussion. No? All in favor? Oh. Keith, I'm sorry.
And if we're not able to meet expenses, then the school board will cover the difference?
No.
Okay.
We'll turn the lights off.
I would say that that's information that would be factored into the extracurricular discussion, and I would hope that we would have that when the extracurricular discussion happens, and then we would revisit the fee structure.
And Keith, just for clarification purposes, I say no so quickly in view of what happened in Portland, where money that was not in the budget was paid out by the school board.
Yeah, I
don't want us to be in the same place.
Keith, do you really feel that 3 and 1 for on a temporary basis is going to not allow us to cover expenses?
No, it won't.
I think it might be close, especially at football games.
Okay, because of the security and the lights.
Security, lights, porta-potties.
Porta-potties.
I can take those all up. There are a number of things that the costs that have come up that we didn't anticipate ahead of time.
And just so I can check to be sure, we do not know yet. Have we received bills to tell us how much the lights are costing us in any one evening game? Because my sense was we don't have that sense yet for those brand new lights. Am I correct?
So can't we keep the current fee structure as I'm going to support Trisha's recommendation until we get costs in that can be then used to determine what the rate should be to cover those costs.
So you want to support the 3 and the 1.
I think until we get an actual picture of what the costs are that we're trying to cover, it seems like it's very random. And given that we already have in place over the number of years 3 and 1 in basketball, it's a lot more of a tenable position for me personally as a board member to support.
See, I guess the difference with basketball is you have bathrooms in the school.
One police officer.
Right.
And the lights are on.
In somebody's home.
No police officers at basketball?
One. Inside.
Linda?
I.
Do you mind if we hear from Katie and Martha?
Kathy, yes. Can it be a problem?
Interesting.
Until we get a sense of Arthur's life bill and things like that.
Do we have a sense of when we'll get those expenses?
Well, first of all, they're just starting to turn lights on for night games now, because it's usually not dark enough for them to have the lights on until the end of the varsity game. Mm-hmm. But as far as the police are concerned, that's, and correct me if I'm wrong, Keith, but one of the biggest expenses that we know that we have right now is the police coverage.
I'd like to withdraw my motion.
Okay.
Second.
Thank you.
If you withdraw a motion, though, the person who seconded has to withdraw the second, doesn't he?
Kevin, you're withdrawing your second.
I withdraw the second.
Okay, did anybody want to discuss the withdrawal? No? Do we have to vote on that, Mary?
If they withdraw them, you don't have to vote on
it. Okay, that's what I thought. It was the table we had to. Okay. Does anybody else want to make a motion?
I move that we leave the fees as is until which time extracurricular has time to review the current expenses and move forward with a fee structure that it accommodates the different athletics.
Thank you, Linda. Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
Thank you, Trish. Give to Trish this time.
Yep.
Further discussion?
Just to clarify that I think it's important to note that if, the, as Linda pointed out, that if the collections exceed the costs, they will return to the sports programs.
That's correct. That's the way it's set up now.
Correct.
That's the way it's set up. You can see what a great time we've had with this so far. And this is just tonight's version. All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. And thank you for your input. Keep it coming. Okay. Report on opening of school.
I have two teachers sitting down there.
Yes.
We're here because of a field trip request.
Okay.
And we've gone so much longer than we planned on this. I would ask if you could move that one out so that they can discuss that quickly.
Anybody disagree with that?
None.
No? Okay.
And that's 10C, which is the Italy and Spain field trip. And also Lisa Melanson, Ms. Hammond, also. What you have is their formats in your packet. There's one I mentioned to you on August, the day in August, I think, what day that one.
21st.
What you have is the authorization form, which is the new and revised authorization form. You have the request from Lisa, and she also has provided insurance information, et cetera. So since Lisa is here, Lisa, if you want to speak to this for a few minutes, and then we can move on that and allow you to go home and plan homework for another day for someone.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize you were out enjoying our other conversations.
Okay, thank you, Susan. I'm Lisa Melanson, and this is Hannah Jones. We're here tonight to describe briefly our plans for a trip to Italy and Spain, and to ask that the school board consider this a school-sanctioned trip. And by doing that, you would allow us the opportunity to publicize this EF Educational Tours trip to Rome, Florence, Genoa, and Barcelona. It would allow us to publicize it within the school day, or at least after school. Also, I think in our favor, we have a history at Cape Elizabeth of successful trips abroad. I think our trip has many connections to district goals and to the mission of our schools.
Yeah, we talked about the fact that it says in the mission statement that education must prepare students to be competent individuals and productive citizens. And we believe that students can't be productive citizens unless they're global citizens at this point. So we feel it's really, having done a trip together last year, we saw the benefits of traveling abroad with the students in an educational trip. We know that there's no specific class called Italy and Florence, so we can't certainly make the curricular connection there, but we saw connections happening in the minds of our students all the way through the trip. For example, we were looking at an abbey, a ruin, and our tour guide said, this was all destroyed because of the Protestant Reformation. And all of the students sort of went, oh, Protestant Reformation, we know about that. And suddenly it had implications beyond something that they learned in history class. And we feel that the Italy and Florence trip will certainly be full of those connections to architecture, art history, history, literature. It almost goes without saying, right? Because that's one of the biggest reasons that people go and visit those places, is their many connections to liberal arts sort of education. Mm-hmm. So,
did you have any questions for us, given that you have some documents for you?
This is the abbreviated version.
Yes.
Curiosity question.
Yeah.
How long in Florence?
I'm sorry?
How many days in Florence?
We get 2 days in Rome, 2 days in Florence. We take a ferry from, I know.
Pass up Rome and go to Florence.
I'm a fan too, but it's 2.5 days actually, good. I think. And then a little bit of time in Genoa. I want to take a side trip to Siena because we can take a side trip to Pisa, but, you know, I can look
you
at...
You can easily do day trip to Siena and San Germano, right at the central station in Florence.
Thanks. Maybe I should get some tips.
Very inexpensive.
Where we go. Mm. Yeah. Providing that our trip's approved.
Any other questions? Trish?
I think it sounds wonderful. I just have stickler questions.
Sure.
All other parent chaperones have attended volunteer training. You said no. Am I assuming that I'm correct in assuming that once you have your pre-chaperone meeting, they will be trained?
Yes.
Absolutely.
So that will change. That's
probably
a glitch on this form that we need to. And my second question is, I'm thinking like mini grants at the parents' associations. The approvals. I would think that by the time it came to the school board that we should see the approval signature of the principal and the superintendent, yet we don't see those. So we can get your verbal approval tonight, but going forward, we're living and learning a lot here, it might be helpful to have those signatures prior to its coming to us so we know that you approve it.
That's my oversight. But it isn't only just an oversight. Lisa had contacted me end of August.
Yes.
And we knew we had to move this quickly so she could get the permission. So this came to us without that. So that is the general rule of thumb. I have another one in here from David Peary. It's the same way. David called Monday, I think it was, a Friday with his. So we were rushing to get these in to get the approvals.
Other questions? No? Does somebody want to make a motion? Kevin?
Move to authorize this trip. As a school-sponsored event.
Thanks, Kevin. Is there a second? Trish, any discussion? All in favor?
No.
Can you go? Yeah. Okay. Sure. It's our part of our parting gifts, right?
Have you done the training yet?
All in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yes. Sorry about that. If you want to do the next one, is David's not here? David Perry?
No, we'll do that in a regular minute. He's not going to come, so I'll cover that at that point.
I just knew
they were sitting there, and I knew they had classes.
Okay.
Because I know my principals, and they have work to do, too. But
report on opening of school?
And what I did ask the principals to do, and Dominic, is just to give a very brief overview of how school has started. And so that you have some sense of that as people ask you questions. So I'm going to start with Jeff.
I just have a few statistics. It's going to be really quick. We have 591 students, which is almost exactly the same as we had last year, which is what we thought we were going to have. The most interesting one that I found today is of those 591 students, 500 have already attended the two extracurricular contract sessions we've had.
Wow.
And I'm sure we're going to have another 40 to 50 over the course of the year. So we're upwards of 90%. I think we've done it better this year. I've certainly gotten some suggestions for ways to continue to improve it. And certainly welcome those things, and there are certainly ways to improve it. We had open house last night. I think last year we had a bit of a dip in attendance, was my perception, and this year it came roaring back. We had a a lot of people at open house last night. So that was really, I think it was a pretty upbeat experience, and most of the parents left smiling and well-informed, is what I got from people. What was a little bit different this year in terms of the beginning of school is the first day we only had ninth graders alone for 3 hours, and then the 10th through 12th graders came, and that was different, but it worked. And that's certainly the feedback I've gotten from kids as well. I think it sort of softened the blow for the 12th graders, of whom you have two here, that it was after Labor Day as opposed to before. They might have complained a little bit if it was before Labor Day and they missed their day off that the other students, that the ninth graders had to go to. Hmm. I'm losing my articulateness. I better sit down. Any questions?
Okay. Thank you, Jeff.
Steve.
Okay. We took in, so far we've taken in 27 new students this year who were not on our rolls from last year beyond the students we already knew about. But we've had about 14 students who we thought might be with us who aren't with us. So it's a little bit of a net gain. And we're at 559 students, which is down. We were about 570 last year, but we expected to be down about 22 students. We're only down half that. We started off the second night, we had a fifth, sixth grade picnic that was hosted by the MSPA that was a very good time was had by all, I would say. Nice meet and greet opportunity, good social piece. Previous feedback to the MSPA was about new families coming in and how do they get to meet people and so forth, so good answer to that question. And then we had the seventh and eighth grade open house last week. That was a very good turnout. Teachers were really pleased to see the number of parents, which is nothing unusual for us, but glad to see it continue. Next week we have a fifth and sixth grade open house, and both of these open house formats are more as meet and greets and talking about expectations and procedures and things like that. They have access to the curriculum course overviews online, teacher websites, the grade books, there's so much information out there, we don't want to tell them the same thing nine times and have us just stare at us. So, nice start, fast start. Been waiting for it since June 18th, I think, of last year, and boy, it hit.
Thank you. Okay. Mr. Eismeyer.
Good evening. Alan said brief a few times, so I got that message. Thanks to the combined efforts of teachers, support staff, custodians, maintenance, and the bus department, PONCO started very smoothly. When you see your enrollment figures, you'll notice that it's more normal than it was last year. We had almost 30 kids arrive in between K and 1. So that means all of our last year's anomaly was indeed an anomaly, and the class sizes are about where we expected according to policy. You'll notice a big change in the playground. Stage one of the green playground is done, thanks to Lisa Gent and Suzanne McGinn. We are not planning to charge fees to use the playground, I'll have you know. Also, we've been able to apply a lot of professional development opportunities at the beginning of the year. Even though school has been out, teachers worked on reading and math. We have a new everyday math series. Fortunately for us, we have a math lead teacher, Debbie Butterworth, who is completely up to date on the changes in the new curriculum. So we're looking forward to that. And that's about it.
Thank you, Mr. Eismeyer.
Questions?
Comments?
Well, it's been a very busy start of the year for Instruction Support Department. We have new regs. New forms, all new forms. Department of Education mandated us to use all new forms, eligibility forms. So we have been doing a ton of professional development. We've got all these forms up to date on our new website. We've started the day treatment program that I talked to you guys all about. My staff attended a workshop today. We meet with Yarmouth, my instructional strategist, myself, and the psych people on Friday to start doing that professional development. So we're really doing a lot of professional development in-house this year. So we're off to a busy start. Lots of emails, lots of phone calls, but we've got really good staff this year. I'm really excited for our teams within each building. We're doing a lot of team building. We're really using data to help us make good IEPs to show progress. So that's pretty much the update.
Thank you, Don. Sue, do you want to comment briefly on custodians and transportation and community center and...
Well, the buses did roll the first day, not without incident, I should say. One bus broke down, and it was on the Pond Cove Elementary run. And so we were a bit late, 20 minutes or so, and lo and behold, one had a dead battery in the afternoon, but we got that up and running, and we haven't had any issues since. We did have a couple of bus routes at the elementary level where the buses were overloaded. We anticipated some of it, made a change, and then two buses were overloaded, so we made a third change. I think it's a positive change in that students will not be crossing Shore Road with the nature of the new bus run, and that has always been of great concern to us. So we're up and running. We get a little bit more on time every day. But even the first day of school, I noticed by 3:17, every bus had departed Pond Cove. And every student got home at a reasonable time, so definitely a successful start. The custodians are very busy in the buildings. The buildings look great. They're still tweaking, you know, some of their new assignments, and but I think we're off to a good start there, too. So that's it, unless you have any questions. Community services registration for lottery is tomorrow night, and we expect a fairly big turnout. Our Saturday youth programs actually began last Saturday with clinics, so we're moving onward at a very rapid pace. So, thanks.
I would comment just briefly, Ernie isn't here, the maintenance projects also moved ahead. Probably the one you see the most clearly are the windows at the middle school, the replacement of the old windows. They are in, they look great, but also there's been a lot of maintenance going on within the buildings, and they are still catching up on some of those things. We also, in the food services department, Sue King, now managing the entire department. We have been making some subtle changes, and we'll be continue to do more. And I've been out visiting the cafeterias. The only one I haven't made it to so far is the high school, but Troy guarantees me that's working extremely well also. So we're moving ahead on those. So those are the reports on the opening of school.
Thank you, Alan. Shari, I bet you never thought we'd get to you.
All right, Shari, cheer us on to victory.
I think Alan has schools attuned on the agenda first, so I'll start. I'm dying to do the invitation, but I'll be patient. So first I want to talk to you about Schools Attuned. There were 23 educators who took the week-long Schools Attuned course this summer. It was the last week in July, first time it had ever been offered in Maine. Those of us who took it have another 10 hours of instruction during this semester, and we'll work with what we've implemented and what we've learned in the classroom, what we learned with them and what we've implemented in the classroom. The facilitators will come back to spend that time with us, and then the course is a 3-credit graduate level course. There were 3 Pond Cove teachers who attended a Portland course. Portland hosted the generalist or the elementary age educators, and we had 20 middle school and high school teachers, and Steve Conley, who audited the course, and we were in the high school library. Excuse me. The Schools Attuned facilitators guided us through Mel Levine's numerous research-based books and manuals using collaborative groupings and DVDs, shared personal experiences. Pace was very fast. It was the hottest week of the summer. There was a ton of material. I was actually going to drag it all in, but I'm going to spare you. But the energy was incredible. It was wonderful. And I want to take this time to publicly thank Alan and Dom for making it possible for all the teachers who wanted to attend this summer were able to do so because Alan and Dom jumped on board. As you know, we had CEEF began the initiative in the spring by funding 8 teachers to do the program, but there were many more that wanted to be part of it. But I would like to also thank CEEF publicly at this time again. But Alan and Dom supported the Schools Attuned concept. Dom was bringing in all the information he was getting about RTI and how much this would help teachers in the regular classroom. And they both made it possible for this to happen, and I think it hopefully it will continue. So thank you very much. Included in CEEF's grant to us is an amount of money for 8 teachers to continue to work collaboratively throughout the year. 8 teachers who took the course will meet, we're hoping, once a month and share that information. And we're also, we have copyright laws to deal with. You know, we kind of thought perhaps those of us who learned this could then take it back and make it happen everywhere. But Mel Levine, the Institute, the Dunn Institute is very clear that that's something that we cannot do. But we certainly can in all our discussions of children, all our meetings with faculty, we can use the language that we learned, and much of it's very supportive of what Dom's faculty uses. And we're hoping that people will see, as a result of that, how we're positively helping children with special needs, and that that will encourage more people to learn about it. So Alan asked me to perhaps say a few words from the teachers who took the course, so I just have a couple here. This is from Kathy Hamblin. The vocabulary they gave us was powerful. I find that the teachers who took this have already begun incorporating, this came to me on Thursday, the first week of school, incorporating it into our everyday discussions on students, and that it really helps us to delve deeper into a student's profile. Cheryl Higgins. Shari, I would say that as much as I learned about the way brains work and how to help students succeed, some of my most treasured gains from the week are ideas I picked up from networking with the teachers. Not only those from Kate, but we had 2 teachers from other states join us. I also gained a renewed belief in the tenet that every child can succeed. And David Perry wrote, the Schools at Tune program was very helpful to me. It gave me more insight into how people learn, how to identify an individual's strengths, and how to use these strengths to compensate for weaknesses. Additionally, the program provided me with resources to fortify areas where a student might have difficulties. It was a most invaluable program that I am looking forward to using this year. I found it especially helpful that there are a number of teachers who participated in the course that I can use as a resource as I implement these strategies. It was a wonderful opportunity, and I'm most grateful that the district was able to make this available. And then I had just an example, a veteran teacher, Jamie Michaud. I wanted to just kind of compare that with a brand new teacher who spoke about, I know I'm going on, but it's my time to shine here. Schools Attuned has given me a more sophisticated knowledge base to use in analyzing students' strengths and weaknesses, and some new strategies to use to encourage their strengths and improve their weaknesses. After 10 years of teaching, I needed this opportunity to increase and refine my knowledge and skills. It was definitely worth the sacrifice of having to be indoors during one of the sunniest, hottest weeks of the summer. And I would just ask you to think about what Jamie's saying, and this is Angela Brown, who joined us in the middle of last year. Oh my goodness, what an informative course. I love my resources. This is a course that I will remember and will stick with me over my career. I feel it is imperative for our staff to attend this course. With more people informed and with these resources at their fingertips, our staff would have the tools they need to understand students' needs better, teach them better, individualized, and strengthen our RTI strategies. I have a few inspiring quotes from Mel Levine that I saved for inspiration. Ignoring specialization and forcing a mind to do something it's not good at is misuse of a mind. One of your greatest weaknesses in school may become your greatest strength as an adult. Fair is not that everyone gets the same. Fair is that everyone gets what they need. So I actually have a few more, but I'm going to go easy on you. And this is just an example. This came from Lynn Spadinger. She's already broken up the constructs, and she has a set that she is putting around the room so that she can have these conversations with the children about their learning styles. So, powerful stuff. Any questions about Schools Attuned?
You mentioned there were some copyright issues, but would that prevent us from placing these materials in the media center, someplace where all teachers can, or even the superintendent's office, where teachers could gain access to it.
Yes, the materials that we were part of the course, we really went around and around about this. Those materials, Rebecca, are only for the people who took the course because it includes, I should have brought, there's also an incredible strategies manual about this thing. But all of the books that Mel Levine has published can certainly go in the libraries. That's a good question. That was the kind of...
But I think the important follow-up to that is, and you made that point very clearly, I have not seen as much enthusiasm from teachers who've gone out to courses in a long time, and I've been around in a long time, as there is with this. And Shari will tell you, I pushed her really hard before I even agreed to this to be sure it was going to be worthwhile. And it has been. And so I think it is something that we need to continue year by year in training. And I've already had requests for that. Yeah. So I'm hoping that we can continue this so that it becomes the baseline for teachers and administrators, I might
Okay. Project Blueprint. You are officially invited to Project Blueprint 2007. CAPE is very honored to be hosting the consortium this year. I'm going to assume everyone knows what Project Blueprint is, so I won't give a definition. And you do know it was begun by CAPE Elizabeth Superintendent Tom Porcella and two other superintendents in the nation several years ago. It's a gathering of educators from six similar socioeconomic communities. And it's an annual opportunity for us to study an educational concern. Last year, Clayton hosted us, and we spent some time at Harvard, as you know, and learned more about the research that's out there about high-performing schools, and also a way to introduce data as a means to improve instruction. And that was, of course, DataWise that I know you're familiar with. This year, we have about 23 guests who will join us at Fort Williams on Sunday, September 30th, for a lobster cookout and an opportunity to talk about our schools and work that has been going on throughout the year since we last met. Monday morning, presenter Jennifer Steele will discuss her second published book, which is a follow-up to the DataWise book that you are familiar with from last year's work. And Poncove is chapter 2. I believe it comes out this fall. I'm not sure about that, Tom. Are you? No, soon, I think. But the second book actually takes a look at specific schools in New England who implemented DataWise and how that worked for them. And that's why we're part of that book. The afternoon of Monday, Tony Fortier, I believe his last name is, who is an educator from Whitefish Bay, is going to work with all the districts and share an analysis of the student interest survey that all of the high schools administered. So we'll actually have some common data, and it's on students' opinion of how the school's going, so that we can discuss that Monday afternoon. Monday evening, we will go as a group to a local restaurant. And that's the first chance that we will have for attendees to match up with people with similar jobs in their district. So it'll be an opportunity for high school principals to be with high school principals, middle school principals with middle school principals, and instructional support people. So that's Monday evening. And then Tuesday morning, we'll have a tour of the buildings with a specific, they've all asked to see the Achievement Center. The high school, and then we'll meet in the media center at Pond Cove in the morning, and we, the DataWise team at Pond Cove is going to do a presentation on our work through last year, which you are familiar with, and I think at that time we probably will spend an hour or so sort of talking about where we all are in the process of data and what we need to do to move forward for next year. And then we send everyone off with a lunchbox and a gift from Cape Elizabeth. So you are all invited to attend every single thing going on, or if you want to just step into something of interest to you.
Great.
Any questions?
And again, I'll just take a minute to thank Shari. She is the cheerleader. She's the one who's kept contact with everyone and kept organizing this and keeping it ahead. Tomorrow? We meet to finalize all of the plans and make sure they're in place. We do have a local teacher who will be the doing the lobster bake for us at Fort Williams. And so we're looking forward to that as an introduction. This is also, it's a great honor for us to have them all coming here, and also a great honor to have the number of them coming here that we hadn't expected. So we're real pleased with that. And I thank Shari for all the work she's done.
Thank you, welcome. I think Maine is a real draw. A lot of people are coming a few days early, you know, bringing their wives and husbands. So.
What other schools will be here? I'm sorry.
I might need some help with this. Clayton?
Wayland?
Wayland hosted us last time. It wasn't Clayton. Wayland is in Massachusetts. Clayton, Missouri. Adina. Thank you. Whitefish Bay.
Edina.
And we had Tom Priscilla is going to be bringing, he's coming with two people representing his school. It's the first time he's brought his school here, but he's decided to come, so.
Thank
you.
Thank you, Shari. Unfinished business, Trish. Policies for second reading. I guess we're starting with DID.
Policy DID, inventories. I would like to move that we approve this policy as presented.
Second.
Okay, we have 2 seconds. Discussion? Questions? All in favor? 7-0.
The next policy is JJI, which is the athletic policy, philosophies, and beliefs. I do not believe there's anything in there that relates to gate receipts and admissions.
No.
Do you need to spell the word athletic on the front, the top of the first page? No, you don't. You have it.
I don't have it.
We're missing a C. I can do this.
Okay. So we have one spelling. Oh.
I'll send that to Mary, the English teacher.
I never said I taught spelling. I would like to move that we approve this, the policy JJI athletic policy with the spelling correction as indicated, as presented.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
JJ-R, the athletic guidelines. I don't know that we need to technically vote on it. I think since it's helpful, it supports this policy, its philosophies and beliefs, it includes a flow chart, so I don't think we need a vote. KF, community use of facilities.
I'm sorry, Trish, you do need a vote, you just don't need a first reading and a second.
Oh, I'm sorry, well, okay, we've already had, okay, so I'll move it to vote because we probably should have done this in June. Okay, I move that we approve the athletic JJI-R athletic guidelines as presented.
Second.
Thank you, Kevin. Discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
Okay, KF, community use of school facilities. I move that we approve this policy as presented.
Second.
Discussion?
I'm just wondering, given what we went through this evening, if we want to be a little bit more specific about who is going to develop and implement rates for rentals, just so that if somebody is referring to this policy, they know to whom they, or with whom they make contact with questions. Assuming anybody will ever read any of these policies, but probably would be useful.
They're on the website. People might.
Are you talking about how to schedule?
No. So the second paragraph, second sentence, rates for blah 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 shall be developed and implemented by
community services. Maybe.
That's what the
isn't
was.
Sue? Isn't that?
Why does it go to the town council?
like this may be a little more complicated than that. They're developed and implemented by community services and approved by town council and school board?
Well, let's keep in mind, this is the policy, and then there's also the guidelines that go behind it.
Right.
So you've got a second one there that we have for tonight. I'm just wondering if the policy itself is all right, but the...
Well, that's KFR. Well, yeah, that's for, this is very specific, though, for the turf field, it looks like.
Right.
I just think we need to have clarification somewhere in here. Who does somebody contact with questions?
Let me ask this question. I don't think this is new. Historically, how has it been done?
We brought a use of town and school facility policy to both the board and the council a couple of years ago. We did make an addendum to that for specific guidelines for use of the turf field. So we have a separate guideline, which is part and parcel of the general use of facility policy guideline. Not a policy, guideline.
So I'd like to suggest that we say organizations shall be developed and implemented by community services and approved by the town council and school board. I think it's good to make clear what the process is and who is involved.
Okay, so the policy...
shall be developed and implemented by community services and subsequently approved, I don't care what the word is, approved by the town council and school board.
I don't disagree with that. I guess I would like to ask that the policy committee, we don't have KFR, and it's a very long and very detailed guideline. Right, what you have behind you is the turf field guidelines, which we sort of struggled with how to present. So KF-R are guidelines that support the community use facilities. I would just like to double check what the language is in that prior to changing this. So I don't disagree that we might need clarification, but can we send it back to policy to take a look at that?
Just as a clarification, we also have a specific guideline relating to scheduling of the pool facility as well. So we have a general guideline, and then we have several specific guidelines.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, I have no issue with any of that. I'm just, from a user's point of view, if somebody, you know, were to have questions about this, instead of calling a school board member, they would actually have that information in a policy.
Well, and
on the webpage.
Part and parcel to this is the application for the use of facilities,
correct,
which clearly spells out,
right,
you know, who they contact, what hours it's available, what the rates are, mm-hmm, and all of that. It's part of that, part of the application, which is right on both our webpage, community services.
Mm-hmm. I don't think it hurts to be repetitive. Have that information in multiple locations, but if everybody thinks this is not worth it, then that's fine.
Trish, it cross-references KFR, use of facilities guidelines.
I don't think that's the right reference.
No.
This is KF-R1, actually.
What is?
What you have in front of you, the guidelines for use of turf fields for the school activities, is KF-R1. So KF-R, we've already done.
Okay. And then application for use of facilities. I remember talking with Mary on the phone about that. Do we want that referenced in here? Is that a guideline, or do we reference other applications that people fill out in the policy?
At one point, it was adopted as a package. All of Sue's work in putting together, you know, regardless of whether it was a turf field or back then the just the use of school facilities, I thought we had adopted that as a single package.
I think that's what the KF-R and the KF-E is, so I think that covers you. But I would like to double check and confirm that against Rebecca's suggestion. So I believe these two, to address your point, I think the application, which is as Linda discussed, includes lots of information, as does KF-R.
Okay, so are you gonna withdraw your motion?
Yes, I would like to take this back to policy. I withdraw the motion.
Okay. Is that all right with whoever seconded? And I can't remember who seconded. Was it Linda?
Yep.
Is that all right?
Withdraw.
Okay.
The last thing that you have is KF-R1, which is the guideline for use of the turf field for school activities. I think technically, again, we didn't need to vote on the guideline, but because we did a first reading in June, I will put forth a motion that we accept the guidelines as presented.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion? I'm just reading it quickly now in light of what we did earlier. I'm just trying to... So this is for home games, right? We don't...
We're identifying what this is doing. It's an administrative guideline. It does not accompany necessarily any particular policy. And it defines what a night game is primarily.
Okay. All in favor? 7-0. Great. Thank you very much, Trish. Alan, new business. Consideration of superintendent's recommendations to co-curricular fee positions for 2007 through 2008.
I have one sheet for our co-curricular positions. That's from Jeff Shedd. And this is the student study team, which before this was called the CAPE assistance team. Therefore, there is no change in finances. It's just changing the name of the team. And I think some people are different than what were on the original team. People you have here are David Peary, Scott Shea, Joel Schroeder, Belinda Snell, Sharon Merrill, Brandy LaPointe, Paula Harris, Bill Cook, and Kathy Hamlin. And Jeff has also put on this the junior class advisor, which is separate from this, as Joan Moriarty.
Is there a motion?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation to the co-curricular positions as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Second? I'll second it. Discussion? No? All in favor? 7-0. Alan, consideration of superintendent's recommendation to athletic fee positions for fall 2007.
Okay, I have two sheets for this. The first one is from the middle school, from Scott Labby. New coaches, first one is Mark Ash, who will be seventh grade boys soccer, 124 point hours at a level 3. And he talks about Mark as a respected teacher at the high school. He'll be a great teacher of the game and an excellent role model. The second one is Christopher Drake, who will be the middle school assistant coach for 90 hours and at a level 3. Christopher coaches middle school swimming and is the ed tech at the middle school. He has a great rapport with the students. The third one is Megan Stanley, eighth grade field hockey, 124.8 hours at a level 2. Megan has played field hockey in high school and college. She has also coached for 3 years at Sticks Camp at the USM. She's enthusiastic and brings a lot of energy to the position.
You also have one here for assistant golf coach.
That's correct. School.
There's just one item for all of them. Looks
yeah,
like.
He just was going on that sheet first.
Were you making a motion? I was trying to follow you.
I thought we'd wait for him to talk
oh,
about
do you want to do both?
Golf coach.
Okay.
Okay, no, I normally do each school separately, but I can do them all at once. Yeah. The second one, the second listing is from Keith for the high school. And Keith, I'm going to have to ask your help. Mark Abley? Abley? I'm close? That's all right.
That's the same. You already accepted a golf coach last meeting. He and Greg Sandell shared.
So this is assistant golf course, 105.6 hours, half position at level 2. Mark has a deep background in golf. He has played 3 U.S. Opens and taught golf for 26 years. He'll be a great asset to this year's golf team. So you have 4 in all, 3 from the middle school and 1 from the high school.
Yeah. I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendations for athletic fee positions for fall 2007.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Discussion?
So I have a quick question. I see that 2 of these coaches have experience and background with the seventh grade boys soccer coach and the middle school assistant tennis. If they don't have any experience coaching or any experience in that with that particular sport, what type of staff development takes place so that they are prepared to be coaching a sport that they might not have any background in?
Is that a question?
Well, you probably would be the one to answer it. I don't mean to be putting you on the hot spot there, but all of a sudden I'm looking at this, I'm like, it's probably a question that I should ask, so.
I think that you find in any of those cases, or any of those middle school coaches, that the high school coaches will be working with them, any of them who need help with any of those activities. So normally, the high school coach oversees the whole program and will help out with the middle school coaches as well.
So is there like an official sort of training that they go through? Like, when do they actually get to spend time with a high school coach? Does that happen? Like, when would that take place?
Well, I can't say specifically, when it would take place. In many cases, they come to the high school preseason workouts, which happen before the middle school season begins, because that does not begin until school starts. And then the high school coaches will go and sit in on some of the practices and give them some pointers as well.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Alan, field trip, high school?
That is done. That's the one you just did for Lisa. Did you vote on that?
Yes.
Yes, we did. The French one then. I'm sorry.
So you don't have anybody for that, right? That's the consideration of appointment of school board member?
Yep. Okay. No, nobody jumped in and said they wanted to do that. So.
Okay. So the last field trip authorization form I have is from David Perry for France. He has historically done this several times. What this is, again, is the form which he got to me, I think it was Friday that this came to me, you called, so to bring it here. Again, he has attached all of the information about where they're going, also insurance information. The one thing that isn't checked is the chaperones attending the volunteer training, but I know that they understand that that needs to be done once this trip is approved. This trip is for April 11th through the 28th. Number of school days are 8, and the number of nights away are 16.
Kevin?
I move that we authorize the annual trip to France.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Okay. Moving on to committee reports. Can we briefly describe anything we've done? I know some have not met. Rebecca, Finance Committee?
We met on August 30th. I think I need to say this, so I apologize. But it is information that the board probably, we should discuss publicly. The committee reviewed the 0607 year-end report for both the general fund and special revenue funds. The schools ended the year with $219,000, roughly, appropriated to the general fund. The 0607 year-end energy report was reviewed, and some positive happy news that our actual costs were roughly $25,000 under budget due to a 4 cents per gallon lower heating oil cost and lower electricity usage of about 182,000 kilowatt hours. So our thanks to Ernie for that positive development. The food service report was reviewed. The lunch program ended the year with a negative balance due to higher personnel expenses resulting from a long-term leave expenditure and decrease in sales. Sue King provided analysis of meal counts for both Pond Cove and middle school. A statewide team is currently assessing the lunch program and will be providing recommendations later this year. Sue and Alan have put together a plan to examine what is driving lower meal consumption and will be introducing improved lunch menu information. Another positive news is that the amount of negative student accounts is down to $2,796. So that's very positive. Our next finance, I apologize, Alan, for my...
When is the next
my
finance?
My emails this week about our next meeting. We are meeting Wednesday, September 26th at 8:30 in the Linda, 8 o'clock at the superintendent's office, and we are still in conversation about October's meeting.
Thank you, Rebecca. Policy Committee, Trish?
We haven't met. Our next meeting is next Tuesday, September 18th.
Thank you. Communication Committee, Trish?
We are awaiting designation of a new representative from the middle school. And once we have that person, we will schedule a meeting.
Thank you.
Very well.
So I'll be scheduling a meeting.
Thank you. Question? No. Personnel Committee, Linda.
We haven't met yet, but a correction on the date and time, it will be Thursday, the 20th, at 8 a.m.
Thank you. Strategic Planning Committee, Trish.
We did not meet this summer. We will be meeting on Friday. This is not on here yet, but Friday, September 21st at 12:30.
Thank you. Student Extracurricular Committee, Linda.
We met on September 4th. Our discussion started with a review of the Hanford Field and some of the issues that had come up with the few events that had happened at that place, at that point in time. We were well aware that some of the policies we had put in place weren't working as well as we had hoped they would and needed some adjustments, so our discussions will definitely continue on that front. I did ask for an update from Keith just to get an idea where we were. We currently offer 27 different athletic offerings throughout the year. We also have approximately 20 to 24 booster groups affiliated with athletics and extracurricular. So to involve every single booster group in all of our discussions, I think you can understand would be a monumental task. We appreciate their input. The emails are probably the best way for communication. On that note, I know Alan has been working with Keith and Jeff. This is one of the other discussions we had, to have a meeting with representatives from the booster groups to start updating them with all the policy changes that are going to happen, get some feedback from them at that time, and also ask for their support as we move forward with our new policies and updates and revisions of the old policies that, we're working on. That was mainly most of our discussions at that point in time. We will have some adjustments to the application for the community use of facilities. Sue's working on that. And our next meeting will be October 2nd, 4 o'clock in the Jordan Conference Room. Anybody's welcome to come.
And just very quickly, again, the meeting with the boosters groups will be on September 27th, I think at 7 o'clock. But Keith will be getting that, has gotten that notice out or getting it out to the different groups.
Thank you. Thank you, Linda. Wellness Committee, Rebecca.
We have not met this year, but there are a number of things that are happening in the month of September that are we were planning for last spring that I would like to mention. The week of September 24th is a program called PAC that Paula Harris has been coordinating with Sue King and Gina Rossi. For Pond Cove, there's going to be this discussion about healthy eating by varying a color every day of the week. And Sue King did note that on her menu and is planning to participate, so that will be good. And I saw today from Tom that there's some information coming out about October being Walk Ride to School Month, so I'm sure that Sue will be looking at that and trying to coordinate something here with our schools. And lastly, I know that we had discussed Harvest Week for September, but I'm wondering if that's not going to be happening this year. Okay, great. And our next meeting is Monday, October 1st at 3:15.
Thanks, Rebecca. Kevin, PATS.
The first meeting of the year and my last meeting as chair is next Thursday from 12 to 2. In view of what's been going on in Portland, we don't have an agenda yet.
Thank you, Kevin.
Oh, by the way, Kathy is replacing me as CAPES rep to Portland Arts and Tech.
So I get to go to lunch, right?
Well, yeah, if it's still in the budget.
Gotcha. Oh, good point. We may be bringing our own PB&Js.
Yes.
Okay. Oops, no peanut butter, sorry. Ham and cheese?
Legislative liaison, Rebecca?
Well, we had a pretty rough year last year legislatively, and there are a number of laws that were passed that affect policies that I think that we need to review as a board, and maybe would like to have that discussion during one of our workshops. I apologize. That belongs squarely in the auspices of the policy committee. Probably needs to take a look at what was passed up in Augusta and how that affects our policies. This year, obviously, I think we're going to all be watching anxiously and working closely with our legislators around any future changes to the exemptions guidelines. So if anything develops, I'm sure Alan or Cynthia or I will let you know.
And there is a Tabor bill rattling.
Yes, there's another Tabor bill, new and improved.
Thank you, Rebecca. Technology Committee, Linda?
Our new technology plan was submitted, and I would have to be honest with you, I haven't heard from Gary one way or the other, but I'm assuming no news is good news at this point in time.
I think he's got an acceptance on it.
We haven't had a meeting, and I don't believe there is one plan.
Thank you, Linda. Karen, CEF?
Yes, the first CEF board meeting is this September 17th. They're having an executive meeting actually tonight. And the grant proposals will be due by October 15th. So I'm sure all of your teachers hopefully are aware of that at this point in time and will take advantage of it. And I will certainly be reporting back to you as that progresses.
Now, there's the form, depending on the amount of the CEF grant, what is the amount that it kicks out and comes to your office to?
What we're basically looking at is CEF grants that go to teachers are usually below a certain, I forget now what the amount is, but they're usually below a couple of $1,000. So those will go to them, and Karen will be reporting on those. For our larger grants, like the $25,000, the $50,000, the $100,000, there will be information to me first, just so we are aware of what's going on, and then taken from there so that I can deal with board issues around those grants prior to, so that that doesn't become an issue after it's been taken in, but an issue before it gets to me.
Thank you, Alan. Public comment? I don't see any public folks wanting
to.
You're in public, too.
We have one more committee that we should be hearing from tonight that didn't make the agenda.
Oh.
The town Hanover.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. It wasn't on the agenda. Peter. Thank you.
I thought I've already done this, but it's all right.
You were hoping, right?
We've all yours.
Sure.
Easier to find. Sure. Hanover Field Committee met for the first time August 27th. For those of you who don't know, the committee members are Peter Carter, Cynthia Dill, Michael Hart, Christopher Muntz, Wendy Seltzer, Graham Smith, Andy Strout, Linda Winkler, and not in attendance at the first meeting was David Backer from the town council. Ex officio are Alan Hawkins and Michael McGovern. Wendy Seltzer has agreed to be our chairperson for at least the near future. Every member introduced themselves to each other. Review of the committee charge by Michael McGovern. Basically, an easy way to explain that is the Hanover Field Committee is involved with infrastructure only, and they have a very limited means of power. They recommend to the school board recommends to the council. We don't get involved with gate admissions, extracurricular, committee work. We work only on the field, its operation, its maintenance, and any improvements that may come down the road. If you look back 6 months to a year ago, there was some problems with communication. The reason for this committee is to prevent that from happening again and improve communication between what's happening on the field with the school board and the town council, and in the end, who's going to pay for it. We talked about the actual construction of the field and the fact that it was ready to play on, the present finances of the Kids Turf Committee. Basically, they don't have any money. We talked about future plans and where the fundraising was coming from. It's very open-ended. You heard my comments earlier tonight that this town is pretty well tapped out, and it's going to be that way for a little while. So things like bleachers, other improvements like concession stands, are probably not in the near future. I will would suggest to you all that just don't expect it. If there's no funding for it, it's not going to happen this year. We talked about temporary bleachers. We're going to make some improvements with what they're now. We're going to move the temporary bleachers we have at other fields to the field. But seating is going to be, I would say, at best, second best. There's not going to be any major improvements this year, and those are simply the facts. Booster groups are using food sales and concession sales to raise money. We do not have a concession stand. Again, like the bleachers, you will not see one this year. Did I miss anything?
No.
That's about it. But basically, the real reason for the committee, and it worked well the first meeting, is everybody talked to everybody. Everybody got each other's opinions. And with good representation, and Alan and Linda and I, the school board will be kept informed at a much higher degree than we have been in the past, which was my only real concern with the turf field from the very beginning. There will be no more surprises. And the original Kids Turf Committee is very open-minded about working with us. Some of the animosity that existed 6 months ago, I believe, has disappeared. We are members of the same team now, and hopefully that will improve the communications with this board. Any questions?
Thank you, Peter. One of the things that wasn't on here, but it occurred to me, is we have not yet asked Kirsten or Hudson what committees they might like to be on. And I think Hudson had indicated that he might like to be on the extracurricular committee. Was
Absolutely.
That? And I'm not trying to put either one of you on the spot, but do you have a preference? Would you like a certain committee, or you want to think about it, or?
Well, extracurricular is interesting also. I haven't really thought about it.
Okay, and you could be on more than one. I mean, we all are. So, anyway, think about it. And, you know, does anybody on the board have any reason why they couldn't just segue into those committees if they want to?
I would invite them to all of them.
Right.
Yeah.
Because where they are students, if they have the time, come to every single workshop meeting you want to.
And the we have them on the back of a, with the exception of their classroom studies. And we have the dates on the back of the agenda here, but they're also posted on the web, and sometimes they change, so.
Yes, you can be excused from class if they're held during the school day, so. No?
Okay, Jeff's pulling himself off the floor. No problem, right? School board agenda requests. Anything? No? Okay. I'm not going to announce the upcoming meetings. We already know what they're there, and they're also on the web, and we've already discussed them. Do I hear a motion to adjourn? Kevin?
Second.
Linda? Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you. We're adjourned.